Those of you that were here with me, were here in New North, about a month ago, I spoke for quite a while about housing and housing strategy and the city's plan and the vision. I'm going to be shorter than I was when you saw me last, but I just want to make sure that people understand why we're here, what we're doing, why this is so important. And it really goes down to the fundamental question and crossroads we are here in the city of Newton. I'm a data-driven guy. I believe in really looking at numbers. I believe in demographics. I believe that the city, in order to make the right decisions about education, infrastructure, public safety, and all the rest, we must be data-driven. So when we think about the future, the current status of Newton, and we think about the future of Newton, you gotta go and first start and take a look at the data. And I also answer the question of why we're at a crossroads. So let me just describe to you where I think we are and what I think we have to do currently. As we know, the economy in our country has changed dramatically over the last 20 to 25 years. And so has the demographics of our state and our region. On the economy, we know when we look at our village centers that are so important to us, we know that there's been an evolution in the last 15 to 20 years when we look at our village centers. We know there's been a change. The stores, and I look at many of the people in this room that have lived in Newton, raised children in Newton, I've grown up in Newton, we know our village centers have changed over time. We've lost some of the character of our villages. We've lost some of the shops and stores and amenities that were once prominent in our village centers. They are not there. And that's because of the change in our economy. You know, we look at where folks used to shop. They used to buy things within our village centers, the small businesses. You can order online. You can go to Target and buy many of these things. So over time, our villages have changed dramatically, the economy of our villages. And the marketplace for our villages now, when you look at the marketplace for our villages, you see that larger institutions that can afford, and look at those local economies that can afford to be there, are starting to become more prominent. And I have nothing against our friends in the banking world, our friends in the nail salon world, and all the rest. We have good, solid community banks here in the city of Newton and others. But they are you're seeing some of this industry in our village centers become very prominent. You've seen some vacancies in our village centers over time. Newtonville included, Newton Center and others, you've seen a lot of turnover and vacancies as well. So those are just some data points I want to describe. The second current evolution, things that are happening in the city. We look at the affordability of our city and the housing. You all know, when we look at this housing stock, what are we at, close to 80% single family homes? Am I right, James? Somewhere around that. We have not, over time, diversified our housing stock. Therefore, as our economy continues to be successful and move forward and go up, we have a situation, which is a good situation, where the housing values in our city continue to go up. The market rate housing are some of the highest now in the state of Massachusetts and Middlesex. So what was once a city, a community, where we had these vibrant village centers with a lot of amenities is now changing. And when we look at the housing stock, we look at affordability for middle class families, for seniors to be able to stay here. Some of the folks that work in our city, the teachers and municipal workers and all the rest, that are making middle income salaries. And by the way, entry level salaries as well. You have a lot of folks, young people, they can't afford to stay here or live here because the rents, the market value is going up and the rents are going up, and we have one type of housing stock. So when I say we're at a crossroads and we look at our demographics, we look at the data, we go to look at what's happening with our economy, we realize that this city, the character of our city, the character of our neighborhoods, the character of our villages are changing. From once was a diverse population where people were able to move here and live here of all different ages and backgrounds. We had village, vibrant village centers with amenities. It's now changing. It's changing right now. It's not gonna change in 25 years, it's changing right now. So the question for us as citizens, as elected officials and leaders, is what kind of community do we want to be? What kind of village centers do we want right now? Not 25 years from now. If we simply do nothing, which is an option, we do nothing, we actually don't retain the character of our city if we do nothing, because the city's changing. So for those that believe, I've seen some of this, those that believe that somehow if we just don't do anything, we stand in place, we will continue to lose the village character and amenities that we have in our villages, that will continue to go in another direction, and we will not allow for seniors, middle class folks, young people to live here and stay here. It's a matter of economics, it's a matter of numbers. I'm a numbers guy. This isn't your opinion. It's a question. So we have to make these decisions. So I believe that we can be a city that does retain its character. I believe we can be a city that offers vibrant villages with amenities within those villages, shops, restaurants, and all the rest. Destinations like they once were. I believe that we can offer an opportunity for people of all different backgrounds and ages to be able to live here. Yesterday, I was at the Wabin Hill Reservoir opening. The city of Newton acquired this reservoir that was once state land, right? It was some state land, that reservoir up at Chestnut Hill. Some of you guys were up there. I see some of the folks that were up here. And we celebrated that. We celebrated open space in Newton. And what I said to the folks when I was at the Wabin Hill Reservoir event yesterday is that we don't have to have one or the other. The beauty of Newton is that we can protect open space. We can protect the character of our neighborhoods and our villages by strategically doing what we did at the Wabin Hill Reservoir and in other places, north and south in the city. Ruth Ann, you were there, many of you there. And we also can, at the same time, create opportunity for people to live here and prosper here of all different backgrounds and ages. How do we do both? Well, we're protecting open spaces on the one hand, but we also need to look strategically at where we can actually offer this type of opportunity in our villages to both. One of the projects out there right now, it's a little unknown project that a lot of people don't know anything about, Austin Street, in case you haven't heard of it. This little project that no one knows about is an example of how we can address the village center economy, get that Newtonville Village Center, keep it vibrant. So we have destination, we make it a destination, we have shops, we have restaurants, we have amenities. At the same time, we offer diverse housing for middle-class folks, low-income folks, as well as seniors. A city that we're talking about, we're retaining the character. Now, what are we doing today? What are we doing today? What I decided to do, this is a reminder, about a year and a half ago, after we started to understand the data and demographics, so I asked Northeastern University in the beginning of my second term I wanted to understand the demographics now of Newton and the economy now and what Newton will look like in the next 25 years. After looking at that, it was clear that we needed to hire some outside expertise that we didn't have in the city to answer the questions that I just raised about the village centers, about our housing. So I hired RKG and Sasaki, world-class firms who do this type of work all over the country. I asked them to come in. I said, take our demographics, and oh, by the way, folks, we also need to make sure we have good, strong transportation so we address traffic and parking. We've got some expertise, Nelson Nygaard, that's working with the city now, that can help us address those needs, because both of those are important. They go hand in hand, the housing and transportation and parking and all those things, they go hand in hand. So we're working hand in hand, but I hired these guys to look at our demographics, look at where we are now, and look at where we'd like to be 20, 25 years from now in the city of New, to retain that character that I talked about. And I asked them to be data-driven, I asked them to do analysis, and I also asked them to ensure that we have community engagement. We get input from you all. Now, someone yesterday said to me at the Wobbin Hill Reservoir, they said, Mr. Mayor, who gave you the mandate? Who gave you the mandate to go out and create a housing strategy, have a goal of, you know, hitting 800 units? And I said, my answer is very simple. When I ran in 2009, and I ran for re-election in 2013, I said two things. One, I adopted the comprehensive plan of the city. Have people read that, by the way? It's a great document. I know I keep patting Phil Hare on the back, but he deserves it. It was a blueprint that the Board of Aldermen passed, right, Ted, back in 2007, that said, look, the city of Newton needs to look at doing what we're doing right now. Mixed use in some areas near transit, near transportation. It needs to take a look at our housing stock in a real way and create diverse housing that's layered on with transportation. I said to everyone when I was running around Newtonville knocking on 10,000 doors in 2009, which, by the way, people in Newtonville were saying, we got a problem in Newtonville. We need to make it more vibrant. We need to make sure we make it. So I told folks I supported the Austin Street concept and project. That's coming to fruition. But I also, in 2013, when you and I, Ted, were out there running around, we talked about housing. And I said, and at many of our debates, as you recall, Ted said, look, we gotta do diverse housing. We gotta have a plan. And I said, we do have to have a plan. And I said, but we have to be strategic about it. Then we went back and forth, and it was a good conversation we had. But I ran on making sure we had a long-term strategic strategy around diverse housing in 2013. That's what I'm doing. That's the mandate was, you guys said, say, Warren, we're gonna send you back in there. Go create a housing strategy, make sure you have community engagement, and it's robust. I committed to that during our campaign, Ted, remember? And lo and behold, here we are. So I am fulfilling the campaign promise I made in 2009 by adopting the comprehensive plan, proceeding with Austin Street, and I'm also fulfilling my commitment in 2013, which is to create a comprehensive strategic plan to meet Newton's needs in housing and transportation. So that's why we're here. So today, we're going to ask you all, with our consultants, to engage with us. We've got tables out here. We're going to ask you, where do you think we can do this kind of mixed-use housing and development? Where do you think it's appropriate? Where do you think it makes sense? I want to hear from you, because in the next few months, we're going to be rolling out a plan based on your input, Board of Aldermen input, and then it's really going to be up, not just me, but it's going to be up to all of you and working with me, hopefully, to move the needle on this thing. There is a system of government we have. A Board of Aldermen are in charge of zoning, planning, special permits. They work and listen to their constituents, and they make decisions based on those voting up or down on special permit. We have a system of government that allows for checks and balances around these projects, and we want to engage, we want your input. I certainly don't think that I can, by fiat, decide where anything is going. That's why we're here. We need to get your input around it. But I ask all of you to do two things in this process. Number one request I have, which is very simple, but somewhat difficult sometimes. I know there are differing opinions about specific projects. There are different opinions that people have about my approach, different opinions about whether we should build diverse housing in the city. There's some folks that believe that perhaps we shouldn't do anything. There are other folks that believe that we do need to move ahead with this and we need to be aggressive about it. Here's what I would say. I'm asking for civil discourse. I'm asking for respect of one another. You can yell at me and beat me up. I don't care. I'm used to it. People call me names. But particularly between each other, as we have this discussion, we must find areas where we agree, we can come together, and if we agree to disagree, that's okay. Because I know the majority of people in this room believe in Newton, have the values that I'm espousing. We may not have the same agreement on how we get there, but I think the majority of the citizens in Newton are fair. I think that they want to provide opportunity for all the groups that I've talked about. So if we can just have a civil discourse and not turn this conversation into an ugly, divisive one, that is my request. And the second request I have is let's use facts. Let's have fact-based discussions about things. I would request and ask of all of you to do your homework. I shouldn't say that in the city of Newton. There's people that do more than their homework on a lot of these issues. But I would ask that you listen to all sides and you do the research, you look at the numbers. I would ask that you do that before you make a decision about a project or whether this is good or bad. If you have requests, if you need more information, myself, the planning staff are happy to provide it. So those are my two requests as we move through this discussion. So they told me I had a limited time. I was shorter than I was the last time, but I am going to stop here. But I really, really appreciate all of you being here and participating in the process. Thank you very much. I'm going to turn things over, James. Is it to you or Fred? Thank you.
There are some seats up here in the front if anyone is looking to join us for these next several stages. My name is Chris Frieda. I'm a planner with Sasaki Associates. I'm joined today by my colleague Fred Merrill, principal at Sasaki, as well as Kyle Talenti from RKG Associates. Sasaki and RKG make up the consultant team for the housing strategy. Thank you. Sorry about that. Fair enough. So I want to thank you all for coming today. I want to thank Mayor Setti Warren and the Newton Planning Department for inviting us all to participate in this next stage of the housing strategy. What we're going to do right now is outline some of the objectives of today's workshop and walk you through the itinerary for the next several stages of the project. So, can everyone see? There we go. So we're here today to participate in an initial stage of this project involving locating some areas of the city that the public deems appropriate for the construction of new housing. The mayor just outlined a couple of key points about the need for housing, and we're going to dive a little bit deeper into that, covering some of the material that we discussed at the October 1st market needs assessment presentation. And our goal here is really to identify where it's appropriate. Okay, sorry about that. A little bit of microphone difficulty. We're trying to identify opportunities for some new, affordable, and diverse housing in the city of Newton. And the way that we're going to do that today is by identifying your priorities as community participants in what is important for you in thinking about where the most appropriate sites for housing are. So we're really looking to get your feedback today in a couple of different ways around the preferences for locations, as well as some typologies, development types that make sense to you. And just to give you an indication of how we're going to use this as we move forward, all of this feedback, this and the other opportunities that we're providing throughout the project, are going to be folded into our eventual recommendations on specific sites and some specific strategies surrounding housing. So talking about what we're doing today. In a few minutes, I'm going to invite Kyle up here to talk about the market needs assessment. This is just going to be a recap of what we talked about on October 1st. Many of you were there for that. And then we're going to launch into the community participant exercise, and that's at the tables set up in the back of the room. So I'm going to spend about 30 minutes talking about what it is that we're doing. You've seen some of the materials we've laid out already. We'll go in depth as to what those materials are and how they'll be helpful as you participate in identifying locations with us. And then we're going to ask you as your groups to identify some principles for affordable and diverse housing locations throughout the city. Tell us what you think is important. Tell us what underlies your assumptions about what makes a good location for these housing types. And then we're going to spend about 45 minutes placing the Legos around the map to identify specific locations. We're going to take a break, and then we're going to reconvene, and we're going to ask each of the participant tables to give a very brief 2 to 3 minute presentations about what principles they outlined and why they placed housing typologies where they have. And we're going to get into much more detail about all of this as we go. This is just an introduction to today's activities. After the team presentations and after we collect all the feedback from you and record all the work that you've done, we're going to invite you back to this area and we're going to have an open discussion and a Q&A about the work you did today and any questions you may have about the housing strategy moving forward. So before we move on from that, do we have any initial questions? And keep in mind, we're going to do the details about the exercise soon after the market needs assessment overview. Sir?
I have two questions. So I heard the number 800 tossed around. I wasn't at the previous workshop. Is 800 a target number we're looking at today, or is it a bigger number?
That's a great question. Today, yes, the question was, is 800 units the number we're working with today? Is that our goal that we're trying to hit? The answer to that question is no. We do not have a finite number of housing units that we're looking to get to today. The exercise has some numbers associated with it, but it's a very abstract exercise. There is no actual number of units that we're trying to hit.
Does this presume that the solution to this for all the projects will involve entities that have a lot of expertise, experience, and money in development?
So this exercise does not presume any of that. We are at the very early stages of this, and today we're just trying to get some community feedback on locations specifically and typologies that you might be interested in seeing. As we move ahead with the housing strategy project, we'll get into greater detail about all of that.
Talk about affordable housing, and my question is this affordable housing for people who work and make $50,000 or $45,000 or $60,000 a year, or is this affordable housing for people who would qualify for the state housing stock and get us units that would qualify for that? Because they seem to be two different kinds of housing.
I'll repeat the question. The question was, is this affordable for people who live, maybe work here in town, or is it affordable for folks that qualify for state housing? And the answer is it's affordable across all spectrums. And that's actually one of the biggest challenges we have when we talk about housing affordability is at a very base level, affordable housing is what you can pay for housing without getting into what's called being cost burdened, which is a terminology defined by HUD, which is 30% of your gross income. So whether you make $1 million or you make $10,000, there is a threshold at which housing becomes unaffordable for you. For the purposes of this analysis, we are looking across all spectrums of income, and we're going to talk about that in just a moment, is not just at one particular income level, at the lowest level or at the middle level or the high level, it's truly understanding where the need is for the community at all income levels. And once we are able to define that, then coming up with strategies of how then we address that for everyone from the household earning $80,000 down to the household earning $10,000. And frankly, you'll see here in just a little while some of the information of households earning much more than that as well.
Yeah.
I understand that this housing needs to comply with HUD standards, but will it also comply with state standards? So for example, create 800 units of SHI affordable housing, we would have to create 3,200 units of total housing. Are we going to be following that model, and will that housing be affordable in perpetuity, and will it be permanently marketed so all of the counts?
Well, I can't say that I'm an expert exactly how that program works. Our expert on that from RKG is not here today. For the purposes of this analysis, we're trying to understand purely a particular type of housing you'd be more interested in or less interested in, and locations in the city where the community thinks is more appropriate or less appropriate for that type of housing. These questions, which are all very, very good and need to be answered through the process, are beyond what this exercise is. We have not defined what the exact need is, and the plan isn't going to lay out that you have to build X number of houses in X number of years. That is not the intent of the housing needs analysis. The housing needs analysis is, do we have a need? And if so, what is that need? And then what are the strategies in which we can employ to meet that need? And I know the mayor has previously mentioned that 800 is a target that he has put out there that predates this study. When we get finished with this, the intent isn't to say you have to build X number of houses. The intent is to say you have needs in these areas. And I think we're going to hold off the rest of the questions because we are starting to push up against 140. And I'm going to jump into this, and it may get to some of those questions as we get into it. But we'll be happy to readdress if you want to continue on these line of questions at the Q&A at 4 o'clock. So with that, because I think it's important we go through this, we talk about this, which is talking about what the mayor had said earlier, which is the data and what are the needs and how much is it. You know, we looked at the socioeconomics of the community. I'm not going to bore you with the entire presentation from last time, but I want to highlight some of the things that we talk about to help you through this process. Your household projections in the community, you can see here that, and I apologize, this microphone is kind of going in and out on me. You see here the projections for the city of Newton is broken down by age of head of householder. And our largest growth areas, which are the numbers that are above, and I'm just going to kind of do this over here because this isn't working. In the households headed by people over 64 are projected to increase by over 5,000 between now and 2030. And so when we're talking about housing needs, it's obvious that there's going to be a potential for a type of typology of housing that is appropriate for that age group. Not necessarily be the large multi-level house with lots of stairwells. There might be a different typology we need. On the other side of the coin, we also looked at it, and it's not in this presentation, but it was on October 1st, and that's the way we've been trending. We've been seeing a substantial decline in households headed by people under the age of 45, a substantial increase in households by people headed over the age of 65. And so you're seeing that type of growth. When we compare that against the housing valuation, what this slide is showing is the light blue is the average value of a house built prior to 2005. The darker color is the average value of a house built since 2005. And because we have such a strong and tight market and such high demand, the stuff that's being built, particularly on the single family side, is substantially more valuable than the stuff that's here now. And the interesting takeaway I have from that is the existing housing single family is over $800,000. The stuff that's being built that I can't even reach with my hand is close to $1.6 million. So when you're talking about affordability within a community, there's a certain level that is being met because of supply and demand. The rest is being left off. I wish I could say that I could afford a $1.6 million house, but I know that that is not true. And so that reality goes across single family, the percentage higher for condominium, for everything. So because there's been such little development in the community and there's such demand from folks who are already here and folks who want to be here, that the market itself is only meeting the highest end because that's where profitability is. And also, as you all know, it's not exactly a cheap place to buy and live, so if you want to recoup your money and the amount of units you're allowed to put in is restricted, you're always going to target that higher end. And it's not just the stuff that's being built. The stuff that we have here now, and this is a look at what the value of a house is to the sale price that it went for, comparing 2012, the light blue, 2013 and 2014, you can see here existing housing stock. It's not just the stuff that's being put in the ground today. The stuff that's been here for a long time continues to appreciate. And you don't need to watch the show House Hunters to understand that housing values are increasing substantially faster than incomes. And that's not just a Newton phenomenon or a Boston Metro phenomenon. That's just a market phenomenon. And when we're only building to the highest end, and the stuff that we have continues to appreciate at an alarming rate from an affordability perspective, you start to see where the need is starting to come out. When we look at the household changes here in the community as a result, I don't believe this should be a surprise to anybody, is households earning less than $100,000, the net number from 2000 to 2013, and the house is earning over $200,000 net from 2000 to 2013, the direction that the city of Newton is going into. I think the information kind of speaks for itself. And when you look at it just for the seniors, because a lot of folks say, hey, you know, I moved here 40 years ago, I couldn't buy my house today, but I can afford to live in it because it's paid off and I have the taxes. If I were to show you this graphic for households headed by people 64 and older, it looks very similar. Households that earn less than $100,000 are moving out in waves, and households over 65 that still are recording incomes are the ones that are coming in. So it's not just a matter of, can I age in place? It's, can I afford to stay here? And the folks that are backfilling me are the ones that have the greatest amount of resources, which tend to be folks, older folks. So when we look at it from a needs perspective, this pie chart is showing you affordability for ownership units. And the lighter the color, the more affordable at the lower end. So the red is units that are affordable for someone earning less than 50 grand or 48 grand. The dark green starts at folks earning over 115 or so thousand dollars. And don't quote me on the number, it's somewhere in that ballpark. I just don't remember exactly what it is. But you can see here that the majority of housing in the city is just not affordable. If this is a threshold right here of $100,000 household income, you have about 7% of your ownership stock that's affordable if you make less than $100,000. And that gets back to the question someone over here asked me is this for people that qualify for state income or people that have wages? You don't qualify for state housing at $100,000. When you look at it from a rental perspective, it's a lot better. I mean, to be frank with you, you can see here you do have a much greater spread of housing, but when you look at the net demand for housing by income of your existing demand, the folks who already live here in the community, as opposed to the pricing, you still have a mismatch. That those under 100,000, there's not enough of those units to meet the income of your existing residents, not just folks who want to move in, but the folks that are living here now. And this is what this graphic represents. It's the net supply-demand balance, if you will. And you can see here, for folks earning at 80% or below, which is about $75,000, you have a shortage of housing, or these folks, and I'm doing the math in my head, 5,300 households that today are paying more than 30% of their gross income to be able to live in the city of Newton. That's today, 5,300. A lot of them, because there aren't enough housing units, which is the black, to meet the demand, which is the red, are being forced to pay more than they should by HUD standards. And you can see here, I mean, if you just look at the black, which is the supply, this is the supply of housing that's priced for folks earning over 120% of AMI. All the rest of it put together doesn't even come close to that. So when you start talking about housing need and wanting to maintain the diversity of your community, this is really where this is going. I mean, the reason why is very simple. It's a very high demand place to live. You're right on the edge of the city of Boston. You have well-reputable schools. Your transportation access, community amenities, your parks, your public spaces are second to none, frankly. And so it's a very high demand community. And if you're not going to build the supply to meet the demand, you're going to see the escalation of price. And so that's where we are today. It's like, are there methods? Can we as a community find ways that we can accommodate that in our future? And as the market continues, if we do nothing like the mayor talked about earlier, what will happen is you will continue to become more and more unaffordable. And folks that in the past have been able to be here, in fact, frankly, have lived here all their lives, are going to find themselves no longer able to do so and unable to find a location within the city to relocate to. And that really goes down to that bottom point, which is your diversity is threatened. The economics of new construction have changed. As we talk, I'm not going to belabor this too much. A lot of it, as I mentioned earlier, comes with the cost of acquiring land, the inability to put back enough units to mitigate that cost of land across a number of housing units, which as a result drives you towards the highest prices in the market. You know, and your values continue to increase. Your sales prices, your rent prices, the cost of redevelopment, all continue to go up under this do nothing, if you will, approach. And, you know, the result is the continual polarization. your inflow of wealthy empty nesters and retirees and your highest income households, the outflow of your long-term seniors, your workforce households and residents. And, you know, I can belabor you with stories of people saying, my children grew up here, I want them to be able to live close by, they can't find anything affordable. Or, I went to school here when I was a kid, I'd love to be back in Newton, but I can't find anything that's affordable. And those are the folks that are being excluded. We've talked about this, and I know this is discussed probably every meeting you have that deals with housing, is the two most vocal point of views is preserving the community character and preserving the community diversity. And those are two big points, and I frankly agree with the mayor that says, I don't believe they are mutually exclusive. I believe to be able to have one, you're going to have to be able to maintain the other, because that is the character that defines Newton. And so it's how do we find that sustainable compromise? And all that, frankly, leads us to here today, which is we are going to ask you as a group to break off and talk about, is there the compromise? How do we find a way to accommodate the diversity in our community in a manner to help finally preserve some of the character that we have? And hopefully over the course of the next hour and a half or so, that's where you guys are all going to end up with your individual discussions. So with that, I'm going to turn it back over to Chris and he can get going into the conversations about the exercise.
So for the next segment of us talking up here, we're going to overview the exercise that we're going to ask all of you to participate in. We're going to go through some of the ground rules and some of the ideas that we'll be discussing in greater detail today. It is a rather nuanced exercise, so there will be questions. There'll probably be a little bit of confusion, but hopefully we'll get through it all in a meaningful way. So what are we doing today? We are asking you to identify two things, principles and locations for new, affordable, and diverse housing throughout the city of Newton. So we're asking you to break off into your tables and discuss what is important to you with regard to the location of new housing. And we're asking you to identify locations across the map. Now, we're being pretty deliberate in saying locations and not sites. We don't necessarily want you to drill down to the level of detail that is parcels or lots for development. We're more interested in which general areas, which corridors, which streets, which proximities and adjacencies are important to you when you think about new housing and the type of housing that we're discussing today. And how we're asking you to do it is through the fun exercise of distributing Legos across these base maps that we've laid out on the tables. So I'm going to get into a little bit of detail here, but the important thing to remember for consistency across tables and to ensure the value of this exercise among all 10 tables, we're asking you to distribute a minimum of 300 Lego studs. And you're gonna have 60 minutes to do this exercise. So we've got these four typologies that we've laid out, and this is by no means comprehensive. There are many more typologies that could be considered, and you might have some ideas that aren't showing up on the materials that we've produced for the exercise. And we encourage you to contribute your own ideas of what is appropriate and what you don't see.
So the 300 studs that,
the 300 studs measurement allows us to compare apples to apples across each table. So what that means is you've got some smaller bricks and some larger bricks. And what we're interested in is these little dot things on top of the Lego. So
with all these four brick types,
which each represents a different typology, we want you to count those little things at the top, and we've made a worksheet for you that hopefully makes it a little bit easier. But what that means is you can distribute fewer of the larger ones or many of the smaller ones and kind of mix and match depending on what you see as appropriate. We've got these yellow small bricks which represent single family typologies. And you've got a finite number of these things, so keep in mind that not any one typology will be represented plentifully enough for you to distribute only that. You kind of need to use a mix of them all. We've got multifamily 2 to 4 units, so this is duplexes, and multifamily up to 4 units represented with the orange bricks, townhouses represented in red, and then multifamily apartment and condo buildings represented with the blue bricks. Also on the tables you'll find these typology menus, and these tell you what we mean by each of these different typologies for housing. So we've given some examples of what development of these housing types could be. But again, this isn't comprehensive. There are a lot of techniques and typologies that you might think of that aren't represented here, and that's fine. We want to hear from you, so by all means, write on the worksheets, write on the maps, and tell us what you don't see. Tell us what you like, what you don't like. The more information you can give us about your priorities and preferences, the more valuable this exercise can be. So we've got these base maps, and on these base maps, we've put on a lot of features of your community that will hopefully orient you to the various neighborhoods and development opportunities that exist. But we've also started to list out some of the features that we understand to be very important to the siting of new affordable and diverse housing. So we've got two primary colors represented here on the map. Lens outside and inside, a 10-minute walk to transit. So this is lens outside represented in the light green, and lens in the orange color are within 10-minute walk. So this is bus lines, this is the T, this is commuter rail. Access to transit is important for a variety of populations and for a variety of demographics. So keep that in mind as you're placing your housing across the map. We've also identified some natural features. We've got parkland, wetlands, and water bodies. Some of you may consider these to be important elements for development of new housing. And we've also identified any vacant lands that exist throughout the city. And these data layers are a couple years old, so you might find some discrepancies from the current situation in the city. And we've identified 10-minute walks to grocery stores. So that's a valuable consideration for preventing the development of inaccessible food. We've also provided a couple of supplemental information maps. So these are for your consideration, for your use in whatever way you deem appropriate. We've included zoning, land uses from a couple of years ago, residential lots that are greater than half an acre, so the larger lots throughout the city, existing multifamily residential lots. This is four units and above, so you can see where the concentrations of multifamily development exist, and currently approved permitted residential projects in the multifamily designation. So these packets are all provided on the table. Take a look at them and allow them to guide your placement in whatever way you'd like. I'll take questions at the end of this, but there are a couple more considerations. Firstly, an important thing to keep in mind is that neither bricks nor the studs, the little dots on top of the Legos, represent an actual number of units. So we talked about this a little bit in the beginning, but it's important to keep in mind this is an abstract exercise. What we're more interested in is seeing the distributions and the proportions of where folks are placing the Legos and identifying appropriate sites. So again, we don't know exactly how many will be developed in the next couple of years. It'll be largely determined by market forces and the demand that builds up. So no real numbers today. And there are a couple of rules to keep in mind too, just to make this a little more fun and challenging for you all. We're asking you to place a minimum of 300 studs. So that means while you may not necessarily see the need for a lot of housing here, we're asking you to challenge yourselves to find a lot of diverse locations for these housing things. And for us to be able to compare all the tables together, it's important that we all meet a minimum threshold. Also, at least one brick type from each typology must be used. So there may be one typology that you don't enjoy, that you don't want to see developed in the city or in specific locations, but it's valuable for us to hear from even those who do not support a specific housing typology to see where they do and do not want to see it placed. Because frankly, these projects might be developed. They will be proposed, and it's important for us to see exactly where trends and preferences lie. Feel free to stack bricks if you're interested in representing a greater level of detail. If you want to create your own typologies by adding things together, feel free to do so. We're looking for you to get creative here. And lastly, write on the maps. Again, the more that we can hear from you about the specific preferences and priorities you have, the better and more valuable this exercise can be. So if you have anything to say to us to caveat any of the placements that you've made on the maps, let us know. There's opportunities to leave comments on the worksheets that sum up all your work throughout the day, too. And lastly, one of the most important pieces, don't clear the maps. Once you've done all your hard work, we want to see what you've done. We're going to ask you to present your work to the larger group as we finish up the exercise. And we're going to be walking around trying to photograph your work and really collect as much information from the group discussions as we can. So leave things in place once you've finished, and we'll see what you've done. So this is the worksheet that we're asking you to fill out through the at the end of the project. It basically just allows you to do some simple math and identify whether you've hit the 300 stud target. If you haven't hit it, just add a few more bricks to the map and let's get to that 300 number. Here you'll also see there's opportunities to leave comments underneath each typology. On the typology menus, you'll see some options that you like, some options maybe that you don't like. Let us know. If you've got other ideas, again, this is where you should feel free to comment on that. So just to break down on time here, we've got 1 hour to complete the exercise. We're asking you to spend the first 15 minutes talking with your groups amongst yourselves to identify some of the principles of the exercise, of the locating of new housing. So tell us what is important to you. Tell us what is going to guide your decisions on placing housing on the map. And feel free to revisit this at any point during the exercise if you discover new things as you're going. And by all means, your placement of Legos does not need to abide strictly to your principles. These are just some of the guiding ideas that you have. And then you're going to have 45 minutes of teamwork where you will identify the sites, distribute the Legos, and talk amongst yourselves to see what makes sense in your groups.
People can't reach any kind of consensus.
Well, that is part of the difficulty of the game. Hopefully you'll find opportunities to reach consensus around certain locations, but certainly if conflicts do arise, then we'll task you with working them out. Sir.
Obviously that would be a new building. What about taking a building which is presently in commercial or industrial use and converting it to housing? Does that count?
That's a great question. He asked, is it just new construction we're talking about, or are we also talking about the renovation retrofit of existing structures? We are absolutely talking comprehensively about all these options. Take a close look at your typology menus. They discuss several examples of what we mean when we talk about new housing. Some of it is the conversion of existing commercial or industrial buildings to residential. Some of it is installing more units in existing single-family properties. There's a wide array of opportunities and different ways of accomplishing that goal.
And then if you think of one that's not on there, write it down.
Exactly. If you think of something you don't see on the typology menus and you really want to represent it on your map, let us know. Just feel free to write right on the maps or on the worksheets.
Do we assume that zoning stays the same as it is now, or do we assume that zoning could change in some areas?
That's a great question. She asked, should we assume that zoning stays the same or that it changes? You'll notice zoning doesn't show up on your base map here, and that was intentional. We want you to think broadly about this. We want you to think outside of maybe the lines that exist currently. So feel free to challenge those.
Just to follow up on her question, when you say not to worry about zoning, people are selling their homes to builders. They might have a two-family home, and then you're talking, we're saying, oh, let's put maybe a three-family or four-family, but the space may not be available.
The space may not be available in particular lots. Keep in mind, we're not asking you to identify very specific sites, right? It's locations, it's neighborhoods, it's village centers, it's streets. So there may not be opportunities in some spaces, but there will be opportunities in others. So feel free to kind of challenge the base assumptions that exist currently.
Sir?
How about in relation to schools? Will that be shown on the map?
Some schools do show up on the map, but not all of them. So if you know where those are, feel free to write a note that says that's important to you, but it's not one of the features of the base map.
Ma'am. Should we perhaps be grouped according to villages and abutting areas? For example, Newton Center, I'm not that familiar with Auburndale.
Sure. So that's a good question. The grouping, we haven't discussed how that works yet. On your name tags, there is a number written down. We've got 10 tables. Your name tags are numbered 1 through 10. We are interested in having a very diverse range of perspectives and opinions at each table. So we'd ask that you sit at your designated table, meet some new folks, and see what kind of consensus you can reach. Obviously, there will be people who are interested in sitting with each other. If you can tolerate the idea of sitting at your assigned table, by all means, please do so. but we can't accommodate any groups that need to be together.
In the back.
Of the new construction, other than apartments, are we assuming that all the units would be individually owned? Like you had 2 to 4 family units. Or does that mean individually owned by each family, or is that one family owning all 2 to 4? Or do you have any assumptions in mind?
That's a good question. We have no assumptions about ownership whatsoever. When we talk about new products, we're talking about ownership, we're talking about rental, we're talking about any structure that could be considered.
If ownership structure by typology is important, then write it down. So if you're going to say, we're okay with multifamily development, but we want an ownership multifamily development, then just make note of it either on the tabulation sheet or write it right on your map. But we're not making any assumptions about either one.
Yep. Good question. Yeah.
I'm just wondering what the parameters are. If there's a certain location in the city that you think having
absolutely. So the question was, are there any parameters around the availability of land, I suspect is the point. There really aren't. So we've identified some vacant opportunities in the city. That is not the most updated data. It's based on the 2012 vacancy parcels, I believe. You are not being asked to think to that level of detail. If there are areas you want to put housing, feel free to put it, whether you know about land availability or not.
You're saying that you have to have a minimum of 300 bricks, but you're only providing 50, let's say, 2 families bricks. You're closing down other options when you only have a minimum of, let's say, what if I want 2 families or 4 families all over the city?
Yeah.
And you've limited that. You've limited my choices.
We have. The question was, we have a finite number of each category of bricks. The total bricks we're asking you to distribute across the map prevents you being able to use only one kind. And we did that intentionally so that we challenge participants to think in typologies that may be different from their initial preferences. Because the reality is things will be developed and proposed, and we want to know, or even those who don't preference those typologies, we want to see where you're interested in putting those. And just want to make one point very clear. The 300 number is not for the bricks. It's for the studs, the little dots on top. And the reason we did that is so if one table is much more interested in putting the smaller typologies on the map, you need to use a lot more bricks than if you were placing the larger typologies on. We can get into greater detail at your table if that's a confusing notion. Anybody knows a little bit of a nuance.
So doesn't that cut out what I want on it if you limit the bricks? Isn't it? You're not hearing what I have a plan for the city. You're cutting it out.
Again, you are welcome to communicate that to us through notes and on your worksheet. But we are challenging you to consider the full range of typologies, and we're asking you to use all of them in thinking about the future locations of new houses.
Apparently in the past there were some apartments or maybe it's still a lot of on the top floor of commercial buildings building that's right in the center and it doesn't involve building more things, it's just using what's there. So how would we show something like that or the other centers as well?
Absolutely. So the question got back to the idea of retrofitting or reusing buildings versus new construction. Those do all show up on your typology menus, and if you do have ideas of locations where that would be appropriate, feel free to put the brick down on that area and tell us that's what you were thinking.
It seems like you say you're challenging us to think about where we would put all these new developments, but it's more like you were slotting us into one direction. That one option, it's like, where are you going? It's like, it's not, you know, do you want to put the brick down? It's where you're going to put the brick down. You know, and I mean, you have communities all around Newton that are asking for, you know, in fact, your own Bluestone research says, you know, the housing prices have gone down in many of the areas around us, and they want more housing, they want more people. And it seems like, you know, if these neighboring villages around us could satisfy the original need for more housing, and they're the ones who are clamoring for it, you know, what's, don't we have the option to say, well, let's help these other communities get more housing, more multifamily, big housing? Then you're also suggesting that Newton isn't already built out. Newton is, I mean, look at your map. You're going to find almost every space in Newton's already occupied by something else. So now you're saying, well, take these multifamily apartments and drop them down all over this map. You're suggesting, okay, wipe out the single family houses and give us a lot more apartments. So my thing would be, what is, actually, Mr. Mayor, maybe you can give us your idea. What kind of cities that exist right now in America, sort of, you know, what's the vision? What do you expect, you know, are there cities currently in America that you think Newton should look like in 20, 25 years? Or what's the model that we're going for here?
Well, the purpose of this exercise is to get your feedback on where you want to, which locations you deem to be appropriate for specific housing types. We have challenged you to incorporate all the typologies in your thinking about those locations, where it's appropriate, but there's still a lot of opportunity to personalize this exercise. If you want to use primarily only two typologies, you can do that. If you want to use a variety of them in whatever proportions you want, there are lots of opportunities built out. We're only going to take a couple more questions. Yeah, today's exercise is about engaging you, the community participants, in locating spots across the city that you find appropriate for housing. We can certainly engage this conversation in other steps of this, but today is about the siting of these housing. No, I'm sorry, no, not at all. This is being used to inform the housing strategy from the team in the city, and the feedback will be incorporated in it, which nothing is being decided.
Are we obligated to come up with 300? I mean, the city of Newton is like a boat. So many people can fit in a ship. If you overload it, the ship sinks. And what you're implying is that we can overload this thing by 300 sites.
The 300 is an immaterial number. We're trying to ask you, saying, if we are to accommodate these different types of houses as a community, where would we feel most comfortable for them to be? There's no commitment to anything, whether in number or typology, as a result of this analysis. We are asking you, the community, to say, if we were to have this type of development occur, where would we rather it be? Would we rather be closer to transportation? Would we rather it closer to the school that somebody asked about earlier? And as a result, then it informs us to come up with the types of policy and program recommendations that say, okay, as a community, you said, if you were to have this, then this is what we would want. Here are ways in which you can accommodate that will make it easier for the city to meet that vision. It's not saying you want it. It's not saying you're going to have it. It's not saying you're going to have it in a certain number. It's just trying to understand from a exercise perspective where is our preferences, which will help us create a strategy for the city to then to have programs in place that can make it happen. And if the response on every single piece of paper is none of this period written down, then that's what it is. That's the reason why we've asked you all to break up into different groups, because certain people want certain types of things, other people want other types of things, and that's the kind of discussion as a community that needs to happen, and as I mentioned earlier, to talk about the compromise.
So what you're saying is the 300 is not an absolute.
No, it's just we needed to do it with, we needed to get some dots on the map.
We get the exercise that will be, it's quite clear.
Yes.
You asked us to ignore, or is it least set aside temporarily, a number of very important things, like zoning, which is essential to stability in our neighborhoods. You've asked us to set aside commercial properties. These could be redeveloped for housing. So what I want to know is, if we're engaging in this kind of magical thinking about where we would put more higher density housing, why do we not also have the option to say, to have bricks that would indicate where we want more commercial development? I don't know if you've been told, but our city's $1 billion in debt. We need a stronger commercial tax base and where we might want more open space.
When we add commercial and open space to the housing study as a focus of the study, we'll be happy to discuss those. That would be in a different conversation.
You're the ones who introduced the idea that you could redevelop commercial sites in this exercise today.
This is a housing forum.
And put housing on commercial sites. So if you're saying that you can indicate where you
have to finish.
Hey, let her finish.
If you're saying that you can put housing why can we not also put commercial sites where we want?
Because this is a, as someone out in the audience already has said, this is a housing exercise.
Okay, there's something deep in thought about this.
All right, well, you have, we're not taking any more questions. We have to answer one-on-one when you get in your groups. Please look at your name tag. Look at the number that's written in the upper...
How about preserve green space by developing density in appropriate areas?
That's very good.
Develop green space.
Develop density in order to retain, to maximize green space.
We need to
retain slash maximize.
Density.
Next question. Where's the land? Where's the land to do that?
Unfortunately, because I know it was in the bylaws to not develop it, but Michigan's willing to put it upstairs.
Oh yeah, that would have been, but it's off the market now.
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
But there's something in that area that could.
Yes, yeah. I agree with that. That's an area that's where
so,
that's
what we say. Okay.
But you can use green space to do that. So that's the.
Yes, but the deer are gone.
The easiest way to develop projects is by the smaller developments, such as we've seen in Auburndale. There are several affordable housing units, two to four, or maybe I think even up to seven units in Auburndale that have been extremely successful. And they're within walking distance of Auburndale Center, and they're within walking distance of the school, Burr School.
If you're on Webster Street, you're in West Newton, like
what's that?
On Webster Street in West Newton, there are a few of them like that.
Yes, and Newton Upper Falls has some on High Street.
Yes, these are very specifically affordable. They're not like Webster Street.
What
Webster
price?
Street was never, no, Webster Street,
yes.
No, Webster Street was never developed as affordable.
Yeah.
These have been
what
developed
prices?
As, I have no idea, these are affordable housing, seven units in Auburndale. The kids have been very well integrated into the school system. The families have been well integrated into the school system. By all accounts, it's a very successful project. Not senior housing. I think it's over on it's either on Lexington or Pine Street.
If you go out of Auburndale Center, you go straight down. Okay, I knew somebody lived in there.
Yeah. And so that's something that passed by with minimal opposition. It's been well received by the community. It's attractive. The units are attractive by all accounts, and that is my idea of what's been a successful project. And I taught at Burr School for 25 years. I've talked to a lot of people.
There she said that.
Oh, hi.
Are you not going to stay?
I'm staying.
Oh, good.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Introduce you.
Do you know what
James.
I mean? Do you live in New York?
I live in West Rochester.
Okay. Alrighty. The more I heard, the more I was really getting upset. Okay. And I've been here since 69.
Yeah.
And this is, I can't believe it. The developer is like a moving, the home plate is moving. The goal line's always moving. And it's like you can't get a straight answer.
So again, I'm fairly new in the job.
Yeah.
It's frightening. What I see is a municipal lot in Austin Street. There's only half of them. And I see a village center that's going to need shoppers right there.
No, what you do is across the street is the Orr building. This other that's private land that can be built up. It doesn't have to be public property. It can be done in a way that.
So what person starting out on their career is making that much money? So who is living here? Are people living there who can afford to hire someone?
I want you guys to be able to get started on this exercise. So I'm going to start with the original question, which is about types of people. wanting to be able to know the types of people and these different types of uses. So let's take the seniors example. Let's say, for example, that seniors should be located in walkable environments. And you have a unit type that you've put down and said, these townhouses we think represent seniors. I have like a notation on the map, or it could be a principle that you put up here that says senior housing in particular should be located in these types of locations.
We're full.
No, we're not. We're absolutely not full.
We're as full as we should be.
No.
Yes.
We've got to build.
Well, that's my opinion.
Right.
Yeah, but we're as full as we should be. It's a mature city. It's a mature entity.
There is another option.
You do that,
you could zone the whole place for multi-family and put up 20 square miles.
Here's my solution. High-rise building in Wobbin Center and a high-rise building right down here in...
Whenever you don't allow centers to be viable, the towns die if you don't allow viability.
So your principle is, let me make sure I get them down. You have two different ones.
You're saying the same thing from a different direction.
Not really. You said you want your lawn to stay.
I want the space around my house not to be shrunk. And
exactly.
My house, the neighbors as well. I don't want to live shoulder to shoulder with people in a tenement.
We don't have to.
I have eight units of new construction within 60 feet of my property line have been built in the last 6 years. Yeah. 5 years.
Okay, so no more eight new units. Construction would be one of your principles?
It's outrageous.
I understand.
Yeah. I know. But what is the principle here? No more
preserve the existing character and density of the city.
Okay.
But they just demonstrated that the economic forces are going to change it and
let's not
only millionaires can move in. Is that what you want? Only millionaires. That's where we're going.
Okay.
It's okay with you.
It's okay with you.
We have to accept that one of the situations is people are going to be moving in here. The question is,
when I sell my house, they can move in.
We can, no.
What do you expect that you'll sell your house for?
What?
I'm sure it'll be an affordable price for your house for a young family.
It'll be whatever the market says it.
Well, let's face it. House is going to be in a range that is not probably going to be affordable. Yeah. And when I sell my house, it's not going to really be affordable either.
I've watched affordable houses being torn down left and right all around me.
Yeah,
affordable houses.
I have that too.
I've seen four units of $600,000 for two families, $800,000 for two more families.
Do you live on my street? That's what's happening on my street.
I live on Fuller and Coin Road, and there are four units of housing there for sale right now. For $1,150,000 each.
I can tell you one thing. I live around the corner from you in a ranch-style house. McMansion was built next to me. Am I thrilled about it? No. I still have my property. I live around the corner from you.
You have a bigger shadow.
I live on Evelyn Road around the corner from you. And I can say, I know what you're saying, preserve the character. But maybe those houses...
Preserve the character, preserve the density, preserve the range of people, the trees, Julia.
What do you...
Let me see
if I got this. Too many McMansions are tearing down perfectly good homes.
Yes.
And too many small ranch-type houses are being bulldozed.
Well, they're being torn down when seniors could live in them. Seniors need one.
Who's tearing them down?
Developers. We do know that.
That's because of the zoning. I agree with that.
But she says it's because we're not building enough. When you look at Brookline or Manhattan or Vancouver or any place that's desirable, building more density doesn't make it more affordable. It just brings in more people.
Are you with the press?
I'm floating. I'm a Newton citizen who's interested in everything here.
Julia Malaty.
Yeah, I ran for alderman.
Did you win?
No.
She wasn't an incumbent.
Were you part of Newton Villages?
Newton Villages Alliance.
That's why you didn't win. None of them won.
No, I did better than I would have without help.
We could do so much better as a city.
Perfectly good. Too many mansions that tear down. Perfectly good, affordable houses. Affordable.
Think of this. You're in Newton Center, and you go on Summer Street, and you drive down Summer Street with the
open. I have to tear myself away and try on the table.
You know, and talking about sort of having a spread and not having a lot of families that are at the lower end, a lot of families at the upper end.
I would like families at every end.
But how do you do that? I mean, you look at these houses.
They're asking for our vet principles, not how we do it.
No. But my question is that can those principles, in fact, be followed by the fact that it seems to me you're seeing a lot of two-family houses being renovated and suddenly being $1.2 million for one half of the house. And so the market forces are such as, are we dreaming? I mean, I don't know. I mean, it seems to me you need something else.
I do think this is a dreaming exercise. I think it's okay to dream on this.
All right.
So we only have, once the city becomes
right now we're still on the upswing. A lot of towns have gone, their housing prices have gone down.
I don't think I want to be in a town.
Go to Quincy. Go to Quincy and you'll see what's happened to the prices in Quincy. They put the transit through and the housing prices plummeted as everybody, middle income and low income people moved in. That's the natural progression of the way housing prices go. We can try and change it by building like Austin Street with a few little units of low income housing, but mostly high income housing. Only four or six of them qualify as low-income housing on the 17, but only six of them qualify for the state.
I missed something. What made the Quincy prices dip?
The natural progression of dense building, the transit, the subway coming through so that they had great transportation hubs. The prices plummeted because the density of the city.
Yeah, there was
all the single-family houses got cut up.
If you want to put a note down, one of the things
made it possible for people from Chinatown and from Dorchester, hoping all of those places that as much
can
as
we all have one conversation? Sorry.
In existing buildings rather than with new construction. I don't see why you can't write that down.
Okay, let's do that.
Sagan, that you're hoping as much as possible that any new units created will be in existing buildings rather than new construction.
Okay.
It's a possibility.
Knocking it down and putting up a new building.
That sounds like. But that statement you're saying is much broader than.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, I don't agree with that.
Okay, so is there some place on this map where we would like to see new construction? Is there, I mean, can we find some place there that we think would be a good place for new construction, since that's the goal here? I mean, we'd have to decide which color Legos or which number of bumps we're going to put on, but just, is there a place where we think that Newton is not built out already, that we should have more building? And I've heard, in addition to the parking lot in Austin Street, the parking lot in Newton Center, and all the other parking lots in the villages around the city, people want to put buildings in them. I'm not suggesting that we should. I'm saying that's the plan right now, is to put a building in every one of those parking lots.
At Newton Center, they want to tear down the fire station, and that area is to be developed.
Well, that was a proposal, but it didn't go through.
No, they're building, they're renovating the new fire, the fire station.
They're keeping the fire station.
Yeah, they're keeping the fire station.
Yes, yeah, they're keeping that. But they still want
because
to put...
Because it's got such a hard egress.
For the fire trucks.
They're fixing the egress. It's going to be a drive-through.
Yeah.
So I could put bricks on the map at this point. It would have really difficult for me to do this exercise. Here's a sense, just from my general knowledge. Mostly single-family detached down here with a few large condo developments like Manhattan Woods, right? This has
some large apartment buildings, but most of this is large single family. There's been a lot of condo development in Upper Falls. Lower Falls is mostly small single family, right? That's the land use and the zone
toward the southwest here.
Yeah, the yellow and the orange are residential. Unfortunately, the reds are commercial, and so it's really hard to see from this map.
Maybe I can make a suggestion for us to start that maybe we can all agree with. I think if we are going to have a tall apartment building, it should be along the Route 9 corridor. That way, it can also be along the Riverside Line corridor. Well, if you need to have traffic, where there's a highway is the appropriate place for traffic, and not necessarily on tiny little streets. So that's why that would be my suggestion if we do place a large grid.
But there isn't much land along the 9 corridor.
I don't think we're supposed to be thinking about that.
You're talking like a 2-story building?
That currently exists.
Not
the towers. The towers?
I mean, less than 10 story, more than 5, maybe.
So you want it to look like Route 9 does in Brooklyn?
Well, it's already one of these buildings. I have no idea how tall it is. It's maybe taller than what I'm thinking. Well, adjacent to the Chestnut Hill Mall.
That's
the biggest one.
Well, we don't have to do 10 stories.
I'm just talking about like a mid-rise 5 to 10 stories.
Yeah, you have several of those along Route 9.
So that's what, if we have to play, we're being asked if we have to place things where we like them. I'm trying to float a suggestion. If we don't agree with it, that's fine. I don't take it personally.
But if you're going to put it in higher rise apartments, put them in areas that are already.
And have a better road system and a better public transportation system.
So I think I'm pulling up from what you're suggesting is that you would like to see if housing were to occur, that it be placed near existing.
No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying I don't particularly want this size bricks, but if we're putting this size bricks, that's what comes to mind as a possible place to put it. That's what I'm saying.
Right, but that's not just 10-story buildings.
In general, you're saying near highway, right? Or not?
Near highway and transit.
I was suggesting specifically near Route 9.
Let's not call it a 10-story building.
I know,
but that's, we're getting sidetracked.
Well, this is the number of floors. Thing, and that would be appropriate.
So let's just start with blue bricks then.
Maybe you had to put a couple of those.
Can somebody read the different categories of multifamily?
Okay, multifamily is a low-rise infill.
So there's lots of stores, but there's no supermarket.
And who's going to be the most, because Temptations Green, who's going to be one?
Chestnut Hill has supermarkets.
That'll be a good one, Chestnut Hill supermarkets. You can't walk to them, but I mean, it depends on where you live, I guess.
It depends on where you live.
It depends on where you live.
There's Wegmans and there's a grocery store. There's two big markets there. It was very built up already.
Some of the things too that you could do if you wanted to is if you think that there's a location within Newton that would be a good location, but Roger, I think you were saying it's hard to walk in Chestnut Hill, you could maybe write on the map too, this would be a great location if the city did X. You know, you could do that too. It's always an option.
Transportation is hard.
It'd be great if the bus line went here or something like that.
That's a good idea.
Well, Upper Falls would be good for that. Nothing there. Upper Falls, Lower Falls, so that'd be a good one. You know, the stores there, transportation needs to go there.
There is that one grocery store like off Needham Street. I forget what it's called in the back. That's the only one I can think. Oh, yeah, that's the one I can think of.
Baza, very popular. Yeah.
Yeah. But you couldn't get all your stuff there.
No.
You could get some things there.
You can get a lot at the Wabin Market.
Where?
Wabin Market.
Why don't we very expensive, though.
Not really. A few years ago, they won the price survey.
I think it's expensive. I don't shop there.
In terms of West
cookies.
Huh?
I get cookies.
Yeah, I don't go there. It's not my price range.
Well, it's playgrounds, what I'm saying.
there's the thing that's not there is a supermarket, right?
That's true. That'd be good. Yeah. Just said, to build it up. To build it up would be a good spot.
So it'd be a good place if there were a supermarket.
Yeah.
Okay. So add a supermarket.
Or this might be a better writing one.
Where?
Let's just make a note that these areas
20 houses. Are out.
Okay, I'm going to start a West Newton thing.
I think it should just be right here. Just write it right where it is.
Yeah.
Don't you think?
Yep.
So add a supermarket.
It would be a good place for growth. Good growth, yeah. Got supermarket.
Well, the thing about West Newton is it's very dense. I mean, I'm wondering about some of the areas of the city that are less dense. Like, well, West Newton, where I live, is very dense already. So maybe we should put like a big building right on West Newton Hill, like put a supermarket in the middle of West Newton Hill, right? Where I am is already dense. There's no room. I'm joking, but there really is. Realistically, there's no place.
Yeah, people on West Newton Hill have no supermarket they can walk to.
No, no, but I'm saying, I'm joking when I say
no,
that.
No, but I know that that would be a reason to have one there.
Right. Well, they wouldn't want one.
So this orange is
duplex and multifamily.
Duplex, three to four families.
Well, that was a supermarket, wasn't it?
No, this is.
No, I think it would be interesting to put some, multi-mixed housing on West Newton Hill.
Like townhouses or something like that? Where's what's the townhouse?
Some low-income townhouses.
Right, red here?
Yeah.
Maybe we should need supermarket over here, too.
Little Falls? I mean, the business went out of business. When I was 16.
So if Lower Falls had a supermarket, what kind of housing could be put here?
Well, the thing is, does it have a pharmacy there? I don't know.
They can walk to Wellesley, right?
Wellesley.
Yes, you can.
It's a long walk, though,
That's a long walk.
That'd be a long walk.
Is there a pharmacy in Newton Lower Falls?
I think so. That's like there's a Starbucks and there's a rug store and there's.
Right, there's a rug store.
Skagorian. There's senior housing there. There's like a dry cleaner. There's a couple of restaurants.
So if all about the transportation. Is there public transportation down there?
No.
I can think of. But there might be buses.
I don't know if there. I don't really know.
No buses. No, there's no buses.
I mean, you could walk to Riverside? Is that close to Riverside? Where's Riverside? Where's Riverside Station, T Station, train station?
In Auburndale.
Grove Street. There's Riverside. There's Riverside.
So depending, like over on this side, closer to Riverside.
They could
take a train into Boston.
Yep.
Yeah. Yeah. That would be a good place for multi-housing because you could walk from Riverside to Scott.
I mean, a lot of people take Riverside anyway.
Yeah.
So right here?
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, let's put a building on there.
So we talked about
Shaw's and Auburn is in Auburn.
Yeah.
How about multi-family? Put some multi-families then.
Well, there are other.
No.
I think those were.
What do those represent?
Those were place. These are multi units. This is like townhouses, right?
Yeah, but the blue ones, they're the blue, like, two in Auburndale. Are those the ones that are already approved?
Those are housing projects.
No. This is only stuff that
what
people
are they?
Oh, over here?
Only looking for possible.
Those are apartments.
Yeah, housing projects, yep.
Well, I don't think of condo as a housing project.
Well, I think, it's a development. What would you call it? A housing development?
Okay, so we're talking.
Area.
We're saying actually, what we're talking about is Riverside would be a good location to put housing.
Our Riverside is talking about.
I don't know that.
We're talking about a conversation. Let's have our conversation with our group. We're talking about Riverside.
I think that's a good location.
So, what kind of housing do you think we should have? Riverside.
What are the colors again? What is orange?
Orange.
No thing for like apartment building.
Well, it's the blue.
That's blue.
Oh, it is?
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know what space is
the
there,
blue.
Frankly.
Might be like a
triple decker. Where's the thing? Yeah.
Well, there's going to be a lot going up.
So blue.
It says multi-family though.
Blue. This is,
I think there probably is room for that there. Near Riverside, though, really, right
near
here.
In Riverside, there's going to be
a
lot.
There's going to be
major housing development in there. That's already in the
Oh, see, I don't even know that.
It's already approved. The only thing that's hanging it up is who's going to pay for a big parking garage. It's fighting it out between the MBTA and the developer.
I mean, I keep up with everything in the tab, and I can't keep up with all of this.
Let's continue going through the neighborhoods. So we've got around Riverside, there's no supermarket here.
But there will be. I think there will be. Okay. Yeah, you can walk to Shaw's, but I think there's going to be. It's multi-use. Multi-use. So there could possibly be a grocery store there.
Because this is near 128. It's near
the Pike.
It's near the Pike. There's a lot of transportation.
That's right.
Right.
You have a lot
of trying to leave Newton.
And ice. You have a lot of stalls to do that.
One little area. There's a block.
Well, still, but the block is wrong.
There is one block.
Okay. So here's my question.
West Newton, you've got it.
No, but we can in every single
Auburn. It's one block.
There's not a lot.
One block is fine.
Auburndale, you've got a couple of blocks where you can do it.
A couple blocks is great.
Sure.
You know, a couple
blocks. Would bring life to those villages.
So here, what did you write? Actually, could you just pass
I should.
Well, was it be in all,
I wrote all
we're village. Not talking about apartments. We're talking about.
I wrote blue brick, so it's kind of already designated.
Can you say like all blue?
What about Nantum? I mean, that's
Nantum, absolutely.
Nantum also. Yeah,
there's a lot of places.
Now, I would like to ask a question.
Did you say three floors maximum?
No, I don't know. I don't agree with three.
Three to four.
Can you say ideally three? How many are three?
Well,
how many?
Let's not do that. I'm comfortable with four.
I'm comfortable with two.
I'm comfortable with four.
So let's voice both.
Okay, I would like to ask a question. Is it acceptable?
You could say all buildings.
That a few additional buildings that maintain the same character be built.
Absolutely.
Okay, so now we're changing.
Wait a second. I
imagine some of those beautiful old buildings in Newton Heights.
Yeah.
Right? Imagine building another one or two additional such buildings in Newton Center that doesn't change the character. In village centers. Why are we strictly restricted to existing structures?
So you could say
we
do have the principle of eminent domain, and certain sites might be suitable for
retire.
I'm thinking particularly, there's a gas station in Newton Center, and don't tell him I said so.
I'm recording.
Crystal Lake, right adjacent to Crystal Lake, and distance of the center.
We're
always 10 cents more a gallon than everybody else. I think we could do without that.
Talking about Four Corners?
It's on Center Street.
The concept of eminent
when
all
those churches end before the lake begins.
Going south.
I stopped going there after he ripped me off once on repairs that I didn't need. That was it.
Hairdressing salon next to
that. So, is this not really reasonable?
Upper Falls, there's a block where you could do it. Every time there's a block or two, that's still Oak Hill has almost none.
But even if it's some because the idea to spread it out. It should be spread out as much as
possible. I agree.
It doesn't have, there's two or three stores.
There's not much, there is no village center, and the Shulman Center.
But there could be.
Just because there isn't doesn't mean that it couldn't be.
Okay, that's a principle to spread out this sort of housing through all the village centers.
Well, I'm also saying, Boston doesn't have a lot, so I think they're spreading, adding
If that's comfortable, in certain village centers could add some buildings with retail and housing above.
Yeah, yeah. That maintain the character, architectural character.
That maintain the architectural style and
character. Something in Wabin, and Wabin has that one strip, and that's it. And it ends up at the elementary school, the monstrosity of England.
By the way, Ruthann, I noticed that one of the Goyas was yours.
But still there is room above. Yeah. It's a small strip, but there is still quite a bit of room to build up. And also by the station where they have Starbucks and so on, there is also
room. No, neither do you. Right. You happen to know in Washington. Wasn't that a great show?
But you know about the millennials. In my generation, my husband grew up in Newton. When we got married, we lived in Framingham because we couldn't afford Newton. And that was 40 years ago. All right? Eventually, we moved to Newton. I don't think it's written anywhere that if you grow up in a particular place, you are entitled to live in that place.
About the assisted living?
Why not? We were forced out, and 15 years later, we saved enough money, and we moved to Newton. Why? I mean, this is life. This is life. If you say you shouldn't be forced out, it means you feel that you should be entitled to live here.
It's a big question mark about what happens. Why
not? I don't know. I think
because life is like that.
To some extent,
everybody should be. Why shouldn't everybody in this country have an opportunity to live in Newton?
Who lives in a city is what we want the future of our city to be. When I was here with my husband 16 years ago, we bought a little cave on the edge of Watertown.
Because that's what you could afford.
But the reason that we moved here is because we wanted to be loved.
I understand. But life is.
We wanted to be where people were active in this community. I'm very involved in this city.
And
you know what I see is I see people from Boston College on campus and people like me
that have to care about social causes on
coming together.
We create a city full of McMansions.
That's not what I meant.
We'll lose the diversity of our
city. Hold it.
Keeping the diversity.
I am an advocate of affordable housing, but I'm not an advocate of entitlements. You see, this is what I'm trying to say. We should build affordable housing, but not because anybody who grew up in Newton is entitled to be able to live in Newton. You see what I'm trying to say?
Guys, I think we probably have to get back to putting bricks on.
Okay.
How many?
More than one.
So I have a question. And also, guys, Rachel's going to try to get us. Okay. Joyce, if Rachel's trying to get our attention,
if we were to add more single-family houses, because we've done the apartment style, if we were adding single-family units,
yes,
how would you do it? Would it be splitting larger lots that are those one-acre lots into two half-acre lots? Would you take? Uh-huh. Would you allow a single-family unit to add an accessory apartment so that they can bring in a live-in nurse or move in or have a child move into their independent space? Where would you allow that?
Whatever creates the least density, and that's really the concern. Whatever creates the least repercussions to the residential neighborhoods.
I have a comment on that.
Yeah.
We just went to O'Hara's Pub last night, and going up Floral Street, that whole street has been changed from single family to
two families. Yeah.
You know, adjacent.
Big, gigantic.
Yeah, and when Quince Floral Shop.
Yes.
So that whole block now is what used to be single family units is now at least duplex, and I don't think that's in the.
No, I live in that neighborhood, and
it did not
deteriorate the neighborhood,
it did not.
And it invigorated the village because there are more people coming to the restaurants and to.
However, I don't know how it impacted the well, the Hyde School closed. So that the school now would be the Bowen School and Mason.
They ask us not to think today about schools.
Okay. But
they
ask. Schools are in crisis. They're
but we could do that.
They ask us.
That was
maybe
an example.
Like what we were just talking about, the distribution. That what I'm hearing from you guys is
it's
that if it's distributed across the city, then we get all the schools
So what you are describing is the sentence with this kind of housing, and then radiating a little bit outside.
Just the top
one. Like double, two to four.
Just the top one. So do you guys want to take some lunch?
Yeah.
Turn around.
But actually, this
can you write this down?
Rachel, okay, Rachel Blatt with Quinn, okay.
Radiating a little bit outside of this very center is two family units.
Why does it have to be so close? Are you sure you're talking about red or orange?
Okay.
We have orange out here.
Which one? Do you mean orange or red, guys?
I think she gave me
orange is duplex multifamily and red.
Instead of being outside,
so what
maybe
is
a townhouse. So maybe it could be some combination
more types.
It seems like they're just doing them automatically on every village center. Is that the approach here?
That's been the general approach, is that even distribution, that's what this group's been doing.
The problem is you're artificially, you feel?
I am, yes.
Oh, no, I don't want to be. Okay.
So it actually went down, now it's starting to rise again.
Exactly.
Because households were so much bigger back then.
So it doesn't really mean necessarily more density as far as the design.
Right.
I think we could do.
We use the townhouses to build a wall.
What's that, Bob? Boston.
I'd like to see some smaller two and four family.
I think we need to get some townhouses in Chestnut. I think we need townhouses in Chestnut Hill and multi-family in Chestnut Hill.
Yeah.
Okay.
Suffolk Road. I think we need a couple of big Suffolk Road.
It seems like you're making the areas that are already dense more dense.
Yeah, pretty much.
But it's, there's a natural, in some ways,
we talked about how this was the best corridor for getting into the city and mass transit.
Have you been on the Mass Pike at rush hour?
Yeah, I have. Well, no, we're not talking about the Mass Pike.
There's commuter buses, express buses, and commuter rail.
There's no reason to be on the Pike.
So we have nothing going right there because BC owns the whole world, or do we want some accessory?
No, that's
apartments?
Well, we could certainly have
you mean over
accessory
here?
Apartments.
Oh, no, I'm just thinking about areas on the map that are blank. And we got nothing going on here, like where the Warren School is, couldn't there be? That's probably right there.
Yeah.
Well, we're out of yellow.
We could do some more.
Good.
Yeah.
Of course, the people who are already screaming about Crescent aren't going to be happy about that.
Accessory apartments is good. Keeps the housing stock.
Yeah, no, I like that.
So those of us who have
We should put
house. You look at what?
I'm just being nasty.
I'm telling you, it's probably about 500 square feet.
How are we doing numbers wise?
I think we're there, but if we stop and count, I can.
Let's stop and count.
You could do it. We should talk about that lower
floors.
And that's 13, 15, 95.
17 oranges.
How many yellow?
And yellow is
yellow, but we count yellow as
a tax.
So the yellow
ones are
one unit.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
We have 54 yellows.
Well, I think we should talk about putting something in the Lower Falls area because there is close to, like, where they're close to 95. So something should definitely go in there. It doesn't have to be a huge thing.
Maybe some yellow.
Buy them?
So, yeah,
we'll
make some yellow, actually.
So we added four more, or two more, I guess. Yes.
And that seems to be where it's accessory apartment.
Yes.
It's not single family.
Yes.
Oh, no, she's doing it. Good. Perfect. Good.
Did you just cut that?
No, it's really overcrowded.
Oh, actually, it looks like Newton Center is overcrowded.
So, do we want to put something more in Oak Hill? Or
so we can remove some, right? How many over are we?
We don't have to. Let's just rearrange it. I'm proud of it.
Okay, so what about this? What about, so Newton South has a high, no, I mean, everybody needs to either be driven or drive to Newton South. What about if we build so that people walk to Newton South?
Well, that's a good idea.
So what would we want, a blue or we want townhouses?
Maybe townhouses.
Yeah, put a couple of townhouses. So and I would take some out of Nonantum area, like New Corner in Nonantum.
Oh, we didn't count it as double.
Yeah. Oh, I think I did.
Oh, you did?
I doubled them, I'm sorry, yeah.
Actually,
if there were two, I counted two.
So the red one should be less?
No, no, it's okay, because we're just taking it apart now. Anything else we want to shift? Is that enough townhouses?
We didn't give any accessory apartments in Chestnut Hill.
Well, I think we should put a couple in there.
Yeah, they want Chestnut.
Maybe we've got too many up here, maybe. Because that's a good way to preserve.
Yes. And what's this area right there?
Single family homes and trees
right
that surround
there.
Them.
Oh, that's. I'm
where's
sorry.
This?
Oh, that's still BC. Chestnut Hill. That's also BC.
Well, that's good though for accessory apartments because then you get the kids or even younger
grandparents.
Right. Because BC is going through a big change now because a lot of the Jesuits are now leaving and they went from 124 that they're actually only down to about 25. So they're all, the Jesuits are leaving and they're actually taking them out of BC and putting them in a small home.
Okay.
So that they own the home. They've bought a couple homes.
Great. So do we want to shift anything else?
But that's a good idea to.
I forgot, what are the orange stacks again? Those are
like two double-sized 3 to 4 units.
So it's 4 to 8.
Right.
Well, you know, you could almost put a 4 in here, other than just the, because people are going to go on 190 and on 95 to get to and from work.
Townhouse? Where do you want to take it from? All right.
No, like right in that area. You
okay,
could.
Good. Anything else you want to?
Where's Newton Corner? Is that too congested?
We've got some over here.
Not so bad.
And then what's this area right here?
Newtonville.
Well, let's empty Novantum out a little bit.
But these are the accessory apartments.
All right, accessory. Oh, that's different.
Sorry. And one multi.
Yeah. But then you have to make sure that the parking is absolutely available to all the people in New Corner.
It's
Antum.
Up there. We got it.
So,
we got it.
I know I live there, but still.
No, I'm serious. Of course. We want to shift anything else? Or we?
I did not think we were
going to
get the 3
of those. Team!
It's easier than you might think to build new houses.
Where's the high-density housing in your neighborhood, Scott?
Right here. Right there.
Oh, where's it going to be exactly?
We haven't picked exact.
Okay. We've got about 10 minutes of the exercise left.
We're good.
Awesome.
I was thinking about putting it on your block, though.
Looks like you've done it.
Right.
Don't clear the board, please.
Might have you might have an issue with Mitch.
One person to present to the larger
group. We're going to walk around to see what other treatments.
Then you note that as a concern that will be taken into. Hold on a second. Let me finish, please. Note that as a concern. But if 9 out of the 10 people in the group agree that we should do more, then we have to continue. I want you to say, I don't want another unit, but if we have to have it, at least let's put it here, 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 and here. I don't want any more, but if we have to have it, I'm not going to be happy, but this is better than that.
Well, then can we write down somewhere? I mean, I feel like...
Right there. Where's the marker?
But wait a minute. But everybody doesn't agree with that. I mean, I think what goes on the board is the consensus of the group.
Well, then write it on the map. Say...
Am I the only one who feels like we really cannot afford to have all this building?
Well, no. You're not the only one at all. You're the one at the start.
table.
We all say what?
That we can't afford to have all this building.
I think some think it can.
No, you can't do that.
I think we need, if necessary,
hold on a second, guys, it's important to understand that these bricks don't mean that this much unit or any unit is going to be developed. Like I said earlier, this study is not advocating for another single unit to be developed. This study is saying you have a need, and that need is A, B, and C. And here are the strategies that you can employ to meet that need. Whether the city chooses to do that is going to be based upon the will of the community, the resources available, and feedback saying, well, all right, we're willing to consider this. And the community as a whole is saying the village centers are better than anywhere else. So let's at least try and focus there. That's all this. This is not saying that these are going to be actual units built.
I appreciate that concern.
Let me give you my card. I want, if you can, you can send me a communication.
I think we have
CC
enough.
CC James,
okay, yeah,
from the city, because he's the project manager. I can write it.
Okay.
Let me go get his email.
That's Mount Ida County. I already have dorms. That's really intense.
May I ask a question? Is it okay for me to put that some of us, I guess, feel that Newton really cannot, I don't know what the word is, I'm going to use a fourth now, all of this house? That we're being asked.
We don't know what this means.
The 10 houses?
We don't know if this represents 800 units or 80 units. We don't know.
Or 3,200 units.
Or 3,200 units. All we're saying is if they're where it's relative, where should the density go? If it happens, how should it be distributed?
Well, then can we say that we don't, can we say,
can we say that
we don't want a lot more density? Some of us feel like we don't want more density.
You can say some of us feel that we don't want more density. You can say some of us.
Just say jfreas@newtonma.com.
But I want to, what do we want in the Newton Center where the college is selling itself? The Andover Newton College is closing down and going to be selling their property. Why would go there?
Have you guys picked a spokesperson yet?
No, I'm not.
You have to do that in the next 6 minutes.
I think we can put a couple of these. I'm not going to do it. I'm too controversial.
Yeah, I've done it 3:30, 3:40.
Can I have some blues, please?
Oh, you're just.
Have some blues.
What is the
right? So where do you think? Do you think density should go in all the village centers?
Some village center side.
Which one?
More denser in village centers. Said Newton Corner, Newton Center.
We could do townhouses up there.
Well, they want.
What about Newton up on Falls?
Like 128.
What about Walton? That's right by 128.
Will they be down here in Falls? We have a bunch here.
What are they building?
I agree, put them over.
What about Rick Lipoff's neighborhood, Phil? Can't you stick something over there?
Bulkhead Hill Road needs a high rise or so.
Where?
Bulkhead Hill Road.
Yeah.
Oak Hill. Right about there.
Highland Ave.
But we don't, we said they're not near our, public transportation or
you mean Needham Street.
If you build it, maybe the amenities will be attractive.
Washington Street? 16, yeah. That's 16, Washington Street.
Mixed use. I can have the blue.
The Kessler Woods is about to be developed.
Wait a minute. When I look at this, this is what I see. This group believes that there's. I don't know what our total count is, but it clearly wants to see more infield, smaller units. Either a lot of the blues, which are multi-unit properties.
That's high density. Blues are high density.
We don't have many blues.
The blues are the big.
We got the blues at the interchange. I'm not so sure about the blue at City Hall. But the blue over here and
I'm not sure why we have that one.
I'm not sure why that
one. That's Kessler Woods. I think he was representing the Kessler Woods that's already approved.
Right, but
it's about there. It's about to be there.
Okay, all right, we'll leave it there. Okay, so we like it.
Well, we don't.
But I see.
Although it doesn't count to the 800, I think it's already, it's counted as already approved, so it would not be additional.
You know, let's place that blue with a few two reds, and that will satisfy that.
Also, we need to be careful. Okay. We need to be careful about putting down what they think they will do versus not do. Like, we had some.
Excuse me, guys, we're going to try to wrap up in about 3 minutes.
Okay. Can I ask a question about the group? Are we more inclined to go with townhouse developments versus multifamily structures? We don't have much red. We've got quite a bit of blue. So should we,
I think get rid of
the townhomes before we end up with blue, we ought to have more red than blue. Is that fair principle?
And can we look at the townhomes and the red are the number three, I guess.
Yeah, we get a lot.
Hand me the number three one.
I would go towards yellow and orange, really.
Well, we have. We've tried to maximize
a lot there.
All I'm
saying is up, you got to get some red blue.
Well, yeah.
Architecturally so different.
Okay.
They built one of those right at Mall Town somewhere.
That's number four. Can I see that one? But that's not that much different than this one.
These things. They're building them all over the place in Waltham and Watertown.
Well, that's awesome.
Really ugly.
That's awesome.
Can I see that one?
It's an ugly building. It's
just ugly architecture. There's so much better things you can do.
Well, I think part of the problem, like with Boston Street, is the building is coming right up to the sidewalk. There's no green.
We're lost in the details here, guys.
So
we're now landscaping our houses.
Architecture for high rise for number four is important.
I know, but I'm just, as a principal, do we want to have more yellow and orange, then more red?
The problem is back then they didn't need the schools.
There might have been a half and half answer to that. Why did he sell nine of them? Well, he didn't. That's true. But we could have leased those. We could have leased them. Well, if you like Washington, we could have leased the land on those.
What's wrong with now having
the
money?
Yeah, we get 3 minutes.
Yeah. Senior housing and those schools.
2 minutes to
I think it's final.
Well, this is a case where I would like to have my cake and eat it too, because I would like to have a place where there is senior housing. And that's a different story, right? Having senior housing in a addressing
well, but any of this
versus having schooling, you know, but sacrificing schooling to get schools for senior housing.
No, no, you told me
it's not an answer.
It's one accessory apartment. It's not getting counted as two. That's why I say you guys don't even know what you've changed here. Right?
I'm okay with that, but I think a better solution was if he'd leased them. If he'd leased the land and leased them out.
So what would you do then? Turf all those people out?
Well, no, we'd have to
make sure you get
that
part right.
It's not the idea of like kicking them out on the street. No, no, don't go there, because of course we wouldn't do that. Of course we wouldn't do that.
But I think the principle, but I mean, I say, wow, they want the blue and the orange and a little bit of the red. They don't really use
it. Well, it comes out of this principle that there aren't enough variety.
It's also coming out of where we think this neighborhood is
available. We wanted location.
3 months
ago. We wanted relative comparison between different housing groups.
Yeah, and somewhere in there, I think we should look, particularly because we focus on Andale Avenue, look at all options for conversions, which means, therefore, you're not changing, you're not building anything new, but you're taking an underutilized church, a divinity school, I'd mention in particular. And those are opportunities there for lots of
I thought you were talking about converting Victorians to...
Well, that's a small part of it. That's a very small part compared to what's over there.
That's perfect.
I mean, that could be an you know what we haven't mentioned on the Victorians?
Are you doing that photo?
How about on the Victorians allowing accessory apartments? I mean, it's so hard to get.
That's kind of what we're saying.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're done.
Thank you, Brian. Thank you all for reconvening, and thank you so much for all your effort over the last couple hours in anticipating this process. I think I was overhearing some fantastic discussions, a lot of different opinions and priorities. What we're going to do right now is just do very brief presentations from each of the tables, about 2 to 3 minutes each. We're going to try to zoom through them. Hopefully each of your tables has identified a presenter, and we're going to just get right started. Can we have the presenter from table one, please?
You got to speak kind of slowly. Yeah. The lights off.
Hello, I'm Bill Humphrey, representing Group One. Was not a very difficult task because we were pretty much in broad agreement in our group on the sort of basic premises of this exercise for today. So the principles that we agreed to as a group were that were important to us were walkability, housing that was friendly to the needs of both seniors and youth, and hopefully in an intergenerational way, higher density in existing clusters, higher intensity in existing homes, like multifamily, things like that, proximity to transit, mixed use, and preserving existing sort of green and natural spaces by building on already built sites. Our approach for filling in the map was that we sort of went in rounds or cycles of starting with bigger bricks, working down to the smaller bricks, and then going back to the bigger bricks and down to the smaller bricks, et cetera, until we had come up with a pretty good number. And we also focused on filling in first nearest the public transit and then sort of getting further away from the transit as we went. And then in doing that, also trying to reduce the density further away from the transit, just because you don't want to have high density very far from transit. And we also emphasized in that process, distributing as much as possible or as much as practical across all the villages so that it wasn't all concentrated in one area of the city. So that's the map that we came up with. Obviously that's an approximation, but that's what we came up with in our group.
Hi, Linda Blank, group two. So we had an interesting table. We had, is that better? Is that better? I have to hold it really close. Okay, Linda Blank, group two. So some of the zoning principles, zoning should be predictable and consistent. Housing should have adequate parking, clear and predictable rules for development. Housing should be close to new transit, all things being equal. Design features matter. Well-regulated accessory apartments, and perhaps a dedicated bike path. So our group was interesting. We had developers and people who are for pro-density, so you can see that we used a lot of the blue Legos. I'd like to say we did come up with a couple of principles to think about because there was dissent in the group. Two principles: if all the bricks are used that we were required to use, then density will be a concern. And then secondly, if all the bricks are used, it's clear zoning principles are at risk, that is predictability and consistency. One person said, I don't want to put any multifamily units in Newton because Newton is already very wonderful in character. So there was dissent in the group, but it's worth noting that we went from very dense to people who are not interested in seeing density.
I'm Jay Walter, group three. One of the first things we said that we need universal accessibility for all the housing that we produce. We thought that increasing accessory apartments throughout the entire city was a good idea. It would save our housing stock and save the feel of the communities while still increasing the density.
I don't know what an accessory apartment is.
It's an apartment in a single family home.
Got it.
Building in village centers with transit subject to limits on height and density was considered a priority. Housing attainability for all income levels is an important priority. City, and this probably should have been the first one, the city should have a housing production plan so that we avoid having to be put in the situation of 40B development. And different kinds of housing for different types of people in different times in their lives. It was noted that housing has to accommodate older people, younger people, young families, old families. Basically, the development that we created was pretty much along Washington Street was our biggest density. We increased the...
It's turned a little left, so...
Yeah. Right. We basically put most of our housing along Washington Street where the circulation and the transportation into Boston is best. And we also put felt that we could reuse existing industrial in Upper and Lower Falls. We had some density around Center Street and added some high rises in Chestnut Hill where there already is. But you'll notice that we didn't really have anything in Oak Hill in this area because it's so poorly served by transportation.
Similar to some that you've already seen, we thought that locating near public transportation was very important. Walking, okay, is this better? Walking distance to grocery stores and other things like banks and pharmacies was very important. We also felt living near some of the elementary schools would be a good thing. Some people thought living near open space and parks, locating housing there would be good, the near playgrounds. And there was some feeling that using existing structures versus building new structures whenever possible would be good. That's accessory apartments as well. Zoning, we noted, is going to be an important issue. So our process was really to go around village to village and kind of talk about these principles and how they applied in each of the villages. And whether it was a grocery store, whether was there a need for a grocery store, and where there was public transportation. And so we noted on the map where we thought there were needs that would help with development in that area. And I think we got to 296.
I'm Halina Brown. So we did not spend a lot of time discussing principles because we started out with our table started out with very diverse views, or at least it seemed that way. So instead of spending a lot of time on agreeing or disagreeing about principles, we went ahead and started planning. So the principles kind of emerged through our planning process. So at our table we had two people who wanted to see minimal
hold it right
growth.
Up like you're a rock star.
Well, I can't. Let me put this way. Because I need to peel these stickers. So there were two supporters of minimal growth, four of them were for moderate growth, and one was for significant growth. We did agree in the beginning that we would like to see diversity in Newton, meaning economic diversity and age diversity. So our growth focused on village centers. We essentially wanted to see certain amount of growth that was the center of gravity were village centers, and you can see it on the map. We propose developing the existing 3-4-story buildings in village centers, developing them for apartments, and even considering adding a few more such buildings that would be consistent with the architectural character of existing buildings, like buildings in Newton Center, buildings in Newton Highlands. And then we, from those bigger blue bricks, around each village center, we envision radiating out the yellow, the orange and red kind of developments, which are multi, which are townhouses and duplex and multi-family units. There was a very strong support for putting as many accessory housing units everywhere through the city as possible, and you can see in our map. And we were also in favor of subdividing of very large estates, like 1 acre or 1.5 acre estates, into smaller ones where single family houses will be put in, as long as attention would be paid to not overcrowding those lots, of course. So that's about it. So the idea is that all the village centers accommodate this kind of development.
We couldn't agree on much of anything except the need for accessory apartments in Newton.
Hold it right up.
We agreed on the need for accessory apartments. That was the one thing that everyone in the group agreed on. We had people who wanted dense development, well, one person who wanted dense development. Most people wanted moderate development, and some of us didn't want any. The map, as you can see, shows development over the Mass Pike in several places.
Wrong map.
This is that it? No, that's not our map.
Wrong map.
Well, our development was for buildings over the Mass Pike, the way the Star Market is now.
Keep going.
Okay, we also wanted to avoid teardowns. Zoning could perhaps do that. We wanted some development in village centers, but not in village parking lots. We were hoping that we would be able to have affordable housing, so that we didn't have to bow down to the state's idea. The mixed use in some parts of village centers, but not more than 3 stories high. The other thing that we were talking about was the Newton Andover Theological area that we were saying is going to come up for development. And we preferred T2 over T3 types of, and converting the historical buildings up there, if that's possible.
That's your map.
That's my map, okay. So you can see we put these, big blue things, those are supposed to be over the Mass Pike. And this is the, this is Wabin, thank you. There's commercial buildings there, and we were saying we could have residential over the commercial buildings in Wabin, so as not to leave Wabin out of the development plan. And some other big buildings along Route 9 if we have to have more big buildings.
We have writers in our group. We talked initially about how to honor the people in the group that wanted no change versus how to be responsible also towards the our increasing population and the trend towards moving to the cities. We all agreed that we don't like the teardowns and the McMansions. But you know, how do you alleviate that pressure on increasing the prices? And by adding housing in transportation areas, village centers, and creating density there, then you alleviate the pricing pressure increases. And it also has a secondary effect of helping out the environment, because you've got people, you're preserving green spaces in some areas while building dense in other areas, and you're building your transportation sites, so you're eliminating the need for cars. Let's see. What we started to look at was buildings and sites that were the Andover Newton, Church of the Messiah, so sort of repurposing areas that were either being sold or about to be sold, and putting in multi-use development there, and also condos, apartments, and things like that, trying to create villages in like the Andover Newton area. And we were also very interested in changing zoning to allow for accessory apartments.
I think that's
great. So there were differences of opinion in our group, and at least a couple of the members were pretty strongly against developing a lot of housing, you know, in most places. But they were good sports and, you know, helped us get our blocks down. We ended up with just over 300 studs, and 160 of those were in the blue multifamily style buildings, and 56 were in the townhouse style. We also used a lot of accessory apartments in scattered around the city pretty well. Because I think the realization was that you need land, some available land, if you're going to build more housing. And so our housing tended to go on places like Needham Street that have large lots that are really underutilized, along Washington Street, and a few of the other places. We said that we really need to assume better transportation before a lot of housing gets built in certain places. You know, the frequency of buses like 59 up and down Walnut Street and Needham Street need to be, you know, increased. And that there's potential for housing in Oak Hill, but, you know, there has to be transportation first. There's virtually, I think, no public transportation to that area. But if there were public transportation, then we feel that, you know, it would be viable. Same thing along Route 9. You know, there's some land, but right now it's not a pedestrian-friendly environment, but it could be. And we started by saying that housing needs to be ADA accessible. I think a number of us felt that, you know, affordable housing was, you know, a major component of what we were talking about. Not everyone agreed with that. And I think that's about it.
Great. I'm Jen Cole for table 9. I think we worked a little bit slower than some of the other tables. We only got as far as putting about 170 studs on our map. We were getting onto a roll and we ran out of time. But I can talk about the direction we were going. We focused a great deal on areas that have commercial properties that are perhaps underdeveloped and underutilized and have the potential for letting some people move to those locations who have access to their convenience services. So particular places where we thought about doing that, besides things like village centers, were in Upper Falls that a lot of us were familiar with. There are several underutilized or not at all used at the moment commercial properties. If we could encourage housing to go in those places, there is access to Needham. We also talked about how at the edges of town, by Waltham, by Watertown, by Needham, we would like to see some cooperation with neighboring communities to make neighborhoods that work across town borders. We would hope that new development and changing the use of existing properties would keep the character of the village in terms of scale and style. That was something that we thought was, that we all agreed was a valuable aspect. And we certainly hope that accessory apartments may become a possibility in the future. We think that there is a lot of potential for just reducing the pressure on demand if we make accessory apartments possible. There were a couple of interesting ideas floated that we didn't really put on the map. We just threw them out there and then said, wow, if Austin Street was controversial, how would this be? We talked about developing the parking lot in the center of Newton Center, doing something that keeps the parking and adds density above not only the shops, but also above the parking. I'm not sure how that would float, but we thought about it. And we also thought about the possibility of adding perhaps a high-rise apartment building in Chestnut Hill. And a couple of times when we thought about development that would happen over in Chestnut Hill or near BC, we thought, well, if you start to develop apartment buildings and you start to make two-family and three-family and four-family condos, the students from the colleges are likely to move in. Maybe that's desirable, maybe that's not, but it's perhaps an unintended consequence. And I think that is, unless anybody from Group 9 would like to raise their hand and say there's something I missed, then we're done.
Hello, my name's Joy Huber, and I didn't really want to do this, but when they found out we were number 10, everyone left, so. We really divided between people who wanted no more density and some who wanted more density. Some, we had trouble keeping people from putting an apartment building right next to Mayor Warren's house, but finally blocked that. I guess what we finally agreed on, we could put more density near transportation, but of course, again, that requires us to get good transportation and fund it. We did want to build over the Mass Pike. Sorry, I think everyone agreed with getting more accessory apartments, and if you could take big single-family buildings, you know, houses, and make them into multifamily, as opposed to what we're doing now, which is taking multifamily and making it into large single families. So those are the only two things we really could agree on.
Is there anything else I have there?
I guess really that's it, except for we agree that architecture matters and some of the examples of the bigger apartment buildings just weren't that attractive, which made it less exciting to support them.
Thank you so much for your participation today. Your feedback is invaluable to the process, and we will keep you up to date with all the stages of this project as we move forward and other opportunities to participate. We have 25 more minutes left in our scheduled time here. We're going to try to stick to the schedule as to get you all out on time, but we reserved this last 25 minutes for questions, comments, any concerns or things you want to ask to the team.
Is that going to be on the website so we can take a look at it in our leisure?
Yeah. All of this will be made available online as part of the full strategy website and accessibility.
One of the major discussions in our group was infrastructure, schools, transportation, parking, and traffic. If you don't have a plan for that as this is going forward, it leads to some chaos. And it's not clear to us that there's discussion, parallel discussions on infrastructure and housing.
That's a great question.
James, can we have you for a moment? There's a question about, is there any parallel assessment going on for infrastructure, school, transportation, yada yada? So I figured I'd have the, come straight from the source.
So we've always said the sister study, if you will, the sister strategy is our transportation strategy, which is running a little bit behind the housing strategy, but we'll be kicking off early in the new calendar year. So January, February, somewhere in there, we should have our first big public meeting for the transportation strategy.
And beyond that, schools. If you add 800 units, how many more students is that gonna be, and how are the school system gonna absorb them?
So I can't speak directly to the schools, but I know that the school department has done a great deal of work as far as their
as far as their projections of their capital needs and looking at their future population.
Sorry. The, all right, is that good?
Yeah.
All right. The school department has done their own assessments of both their capital needs and their population projections.
But they don't know that maybe 800 units are being added, do they?
You know, but,
there's so much pressure already.
There's
actually 3,200 units they envision to get 800 affordable. Speaker in the beginning did.
At this point in time, we're just looking at the specific issue of how do we address the needs that we've identified in terms of housing here in the city of Newton. There's always other issues that come up around the issue of housing that we're going to have to address. No one's saying that we would ignore any of that. But what we are saying is, how are we going to move forward on the issue of housing? And that's what this strategy is about. And for those who didn't hear me because I was not close enough to the mic, we are also doing a transportation strategy. There should be the first big public meeting for that should be somewhere in the January, February timeframe. We're working to nail down those dates right now.
Yep.
Part question. We build the 800 units, whatever number of units, what's going to keep those from the price of those units as they get turned over, going up with the market, becoming market price, being priced out of the market just like we are today?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, 800 units is a drop in the bucket. The other issue is the accessory apartment situation that I'm hearing everyone talking about. You and I discussed this mm-hmm. in the last meeting. There was, 20 years ago maybe, the Board of Aldermen, there were like 300 illegal apartments in the city of Newton. So the Board of Aldermen tried to make them legal, came with a mechanism. And I think three apartments showed up and registered themselves because they all didn't meet building code. So now, what are you going to do? Part of the reason for accessory apartments is you end up with too many apartments built into a neighborhood, you get crowding, too many cars, strain on the sewer system, that sort of thing. What's going to happen here? And also, right now, I believe that if you're 55 or older, you are allowed to put in an accessory apartment into your home. The issue is, what's the break even on something like that?
And I was processing your second question. Can you just quickly repeat the first?
What's going to keep the price of those?
Oh, yeah, yeah. Well, there are a number of mechanisms that you can put into place that can keep the pricing of a unit at a certain income threshold into the future. A lot of it ties around accessibility to federal dollars. The city can put the requirement for access to municipal dollars. If the city already owns the land, you could put that into it as a part of a deed restriction. So there are ways that you can have those units priced to those income thresholds into the future. Now, the reality is you can't guarantee them forever. There are realities that sometimes those are going to come up and you're going to have to either renegotiate with the property owner, or you're going to have to, I think I'm like halfway too close maybe, or try and find additional ways to maintain them as affordable. So it's a legitimate question of how long will they stay that way into the future as you're considering what approaches you take as a city to try and accommodate it. The second question you talked about, which is you had the 300, you and I did discuss this in October, is, and I'm going to give you kind of the similar answer, is while you're not going to be able to address the legal or illegality, there are tools that you can put into place with an accessory dwelling unit requirement that limits what properties are capable of having it to try and address some of those issues of we don't want to see every single house on our block all of a sudden put on another unit and that means add more cars. You can have lot requirements, you can have building square footage requirements. There are a number of tools that you can put into place that limits the pool to properties that are the most appropriate for it. And I say most appropriate because that's defined by the community of what they deem to be appropriate. You can set it at, it has to have at least a quarter of an acre, it has to have at least a half an acre, it has to have at least three quarters of an acre. I mean, that's determined by the city when you look at your land base and then determine how do you make that happen. And so you do control how many accessory units are put into place by the requirements that you put, and that goes back to what we talked about earlier, which is the balance between, you know, how do we address the need that we have in a manner that we feel comfortable as a community that it's not going to materially change our community's
got to change. I just wanted to point out that under Massachusetts law,
affordable housing deed restrictions can be in perpetuity. Can you hear me? I'm sorry. Is that better? Under Massachusetts law, affordable housing deed restrictions can be in perpetuity, and pretty much the practice today is that they are in perpetuity.
Okay, thank you.
My only concern with that, though, is financial. If you're going to put in an accessory apartment, you're going to be spending, I would imagine, at least $10,000, maybe $20,000, $30,000. Break even on something like that's going to take quite a while, especially for a senior citizen.
Absolutely, and that should be considered in the structure of the policy that you can take a look at it from a financial perspective. But the reality is, I would argue, from a policy base, that should be the responsibility of the property owner, and you can adjust the requirements if it's not yielding what you want.
I'm not saying your plans. I'm saying the market's going to dictate that that apartment, by the time you get it done, is probably not going to be financially viable. That's the point I'm trying to make.
Gotcha. Okay. Yes.
I guess my concern goes back to the 800 number of units, which I was just remind people that you're actually talking about 3,200 units to get to 800 affordable, and that amounts to more than 10% of existing housing units, I think.
Wait, could you repeat that?
What was the question again?
The question was that talking about 800 affordable units means you're talking about 3,200 market rate units to support
3,200 total
units, which is the 20% right. inclusionary requirement.
But that's not actually my question. My question is the 800 number itself, I think, derived from the number of units it would take to get to 10% affordable units on the 40B standard, and that in itself is an arbitrary number. And if you look at Newton compared to other communities on a per unit, SHI units per square mile basis, we actually have more SHI eligible units than communities which have actually met the 10% threshold because we are so densely developed already. And it seems like we are penalized and penalizing ourselves by setting a high target when we're already dense. And we have to become more and more dense to meet a threshold that other communities meet with much fewer units because they're not densely developed.
All right, so that all may be true based on 40B. So the question, I'm going to try and sum it up, and you...
I want me to take the mic.
Yeah, please.
Right.
Please.
Okay.
Yeah.
And which other communities? You've got to
hold it right up.
Okay, I'm not very good at this either. It's harder than it looks. So Mike, I've looked at Newton compared to other communities in terms of how we stand on percent of SHI units versus total units. Is it working?
Which other communities?
I don't have enough hands. So we actually have, if you look at, so Newton is much more developed than many other communities like Wellesley or Needham or, several others. If you look at, so we're ineffectively, we're penalized because we're already so densely developed. So when we try to meet a goal of 10% SHI, subsidized housing inventory units, of 10%, we have a much higher number of units we have to get to per square mile than other communities. So when you look at Newton compared to other communities, including some communities that have already met the state's 10% standard, we actually have more SHI units per square mile than those other communities that are at 10% and above. So I am always surprised when I hear people say we're not doing our fair share, because by virtue of how densely we've already become developed, we're doing more per square mile affordable units than many other communities.
So I'm not sure there's actually a question in there.
It seems to me that the 800 unit number comes from the number it was going to take to get to 10%. That's the derivation of the 800.
Yes.
And it all seems an arbitrary basis.
The 800 number comes from the what's left for Newton to reach the 10% threshold under the state program, under the state 40B program, right?
Which seems like an arbitrary goal. So why are we imposing so much more density to get to an arbitrary goal?
This strategy is not about hitting the 40B threshold number. The strategy is about identifying our needs. I think Kyle said this actually quite well at the beginning of this. What are our actual housing needs here in the city of Newton right now, and as we look at the future, but really, what are they right now? And what would we need to build in order to meet that need?
And that's what the data has been that we've been looking at over the course of this study. And frankly, at the end of the day, that's what this exercise has been about, is that if we look at the city of Newton, where would we consider putting housing development to meet that need? Let's leave aside the 800 units for now and think about our actual housing needs here.
I guess I see need versus want, because it seems like however many units you have in a desirable community, there'll always be more people who want to live in that community. And whether you look at Brookline or Manhattan or Vancouver or San Francisco, more density doesn't seem to alleviate that demand.
We'll move on after this. What the data that we showed earlier indicates is, from a housing cost burdening perspective, you have several thousand households that are spending more than what HUD defines as a reasonable amount of money for housing. So even if you take away the demand of people who don't live in Newton that would like to, you have an issue here in the city of Newton that the city has asked us to help come up with strategies of how to mitigate that need. And whether that's making housing more affordable at the already in, or whether it's adding new housing, or the number of strategies that are available to the city for it to pursue, to James's point, there's a substantially greater need of your existing resident base than the 800 that has been thrown out before this study ever started. So, and that's what we are working off of from a standpoint of how do we find policies and strategies to help people who are already Newton residents continue to be Newton residents in a manner that is affordable. Yeah?
I think we're wrapping up. I was at table number 3. I cannot find a notebook that's about this big with a blue plastic cover, spiral, and it has a lot of notes from my job.
The question is, at table 3, there was a blue spiral notebook that was left there, yeah. I guess, that we were looking. No, I don't have a plan to cut taxes because that's not the mission of this project. However, I believe that that is an important thing that the city take into consideration when it determines the approaches that it takes. And as James mentioned a little while ago, transportation, parking, schools, how it affects the taxes of the community is yet another thing that is considered for every project that comes before the city council, or excuse me, soon to be a council, right? I'm a few weeks too early on that one to come before the Board of Aldermen. So I agree that should be a point of consideration, but that goes back to the conversation, and I'm gonna bang this bell as long as I have the opportunity of what is the acceptable compromise to try and maintain the community that we are, the community that we want to be, and then all these other considerations. And if the answer is there's no tolerance for it, then that's the city's approach. But you have to take all that stuff into consideration, and the tax implications is yet another one of the layers when the aldermen are considering a project related to housing. But this study itself won't be making those recommendations because it's beyond the purview of what we're trying to accomplish. Yes, ma'am.
What is the next step in getting input from the community? Because this is partly a representative group of
Well, as always, we have the website for the project that allows anyone who wants to leave a comment about any of the processes that we went through so far. So with all the presentations, all the information that we collect tonight, for example, will be up there for people to respond back to. We have another meeting in January, another public meeting similar to the last one we just did in October. Yeah. Where we will continue to advertise and encourage people to show up and participate in their voice. So between taking the initiative themselves to get engaged, whether via the internet or coming in person, those are the best strategies that we have. I wish I could say that I could go knock on every door, but that's just not budget. I tried to get James to do that.
I don't want you to knock on the door, but I would suggest that you might try to get some
email there.
Engaged in other aspects of the community into so that they are aware of this of the meetings. For instance, I would suggest that today, the Sunday before Thanksgiving,
right,
was
no one
not
could
the
come.
Best day to try to engage the public in coming to something like this.
All my neighbors couldn't, they're all on vacation.
Maybe you can do a little poll of big groups like the Senior Center, various groups, find out, give people some options. and then Tuesday. This, I don't think that it is reasonable to expect that a group of three, four, how many you are, could make a decision about when was the best time to really engage with the community. And you also should not expect that everybody is going to go to the city website and respond like that. You really need to be broader in your thinking if you want to maximize participation.
Well, I would love for you, if you have ideas about that, can I give you my card and you can provide those and we can see how we can incorporate them as we move forward.
You need more than my ideas. I think I'm suggesting that you try to
And I appreciate that. I would also counter by saying trying to organize an event like this is not as easy as picking a date and scheduling it. There are a number of factors from the city's perspective, from the consulting team's perspective, from the availability of space perspective that goes into doing something like this. I will agree with you, this was not our first choice to have it on this night at this time. But when you are left with, I would love to be able to put out a poll to the city saying, here are the three or four dates that we have available, let's vote on it. But you know what I'm gonna learn from my experiences? There are gonna be some dates that some people can make and some dates that some people can't make.
When is the January date?
We haven't set that yet.
I hope it's soon.
So my point is we're never gonna be able to please everybody. Your point is well taken. We'll be happy to try and consider ways to try and set the date for January and the next one in February, but you know you also have to be a little bit understanding of there's a lot of moving parts that go into this that we're never going to be able to make everyone schedules.
There were some excellent points from the other tables, actually, that I wish we had put on ours that are so important. Preserving all the open spaces. It hadn't occurred to us the idea of building along Washington Street, you know, where there was a transportation,
there were some very, very good points, made by other tables that I think are really important about preserving all the open space, the green space, perhaps building along Washington Street, you know, where there already were the buildings and along Route 9. I hope the post-its are clear that when we talked about the apartments, it was above, you know, the third floor, above the commercial building. So really keeping the scale very, you know, very, very small, you know, preserving the scale and the quality, the quality of the centers. And I passionately agree with the point that you made about this, what seems to be a very, very arbitrary number of the 800 and how unfair that is compared to the other communities, that you just compared us to. Thank you.
I'm sorry?
So, just to address that, we agree that there have been some great ideas produced by all the tables. Unfortunately, you didn't get a chance to see them all in the extensive detail that the tables put into each project, but that's why we're going to be placing the images from today, as well as some of the text feedback we got from you on the website, the My Sidewalk page for the housing strategy, which is updated continuously as this project advances. Here you'll be able to see in detail the work every other table did.
We were still in the process of taking things off. We actually ended up having too many.
You're totally welcome to continue submitting feedback via the My Sidewalk page. Okay. That's what it's there for, so that this keeps going.
And I just want to be clear, and I hope maybe you're being tongue-in-cheek, which I apologize if you were, but the number is immaterial to the concept that you put on the paper. And so that's really what we're going to be focusing on. All right, we're going to take two more and then we're done. Yes?
Okay, I just want to say that I think we should focus on building neighborhoods and communities and not just popping down different buildings wherever we see a site. I mean, I think that would bring us together as a city. We tend in Boston, not all of the places over here, the piece of land, like a building now. I think we need to consider everything, and I hope your process does.
Excellent. Thank you. Who wants to be it? First one up, last one to comment.
Mine might be more of a comment than a question, but.
Give her the mic.
Oh, I can talk into the mic if you'd like, if you can hear me.
No.
I don't know how to use the mic. Ooh, is that good? Mine is more of a comment. I came today because I feel like I'm hearing so many different things, and I try to be an educated resident. I read the tab. I have kids in the school, so this is my is it? This is really.
Why don't I just talk loud? Can you hear me?
Yeah. Good.
No. But my concerns are the pace of the development that I'm seeing. That my neighborhood is already a two-income working family. People are so busy. We talk about community. You know, I see the changes that have happened. The community is changing. I live in a really tight neighborhood. We have parties all the time. But it's really changing. And the people moving in, we don't even meet them anymore because they put their garage door down. They're never home, for one. And I have two kids in the school. The other thing I will say is a comment, but before the election, nobody knew what was going on. I couldn't believe how people were so uninformed before the Alden election. Only 20% came out to vote.
What's your name, Julia?
And
Allegate.
In the last 3 weeks, I have talked with so many people who do not own their houses, right? So they're in the process of their 30-year mortgage, and they're planning on leaving. So already people who have kids in the schools are saying, I'm done. I don't want to live. The place this is becoming is not the place I bought. And I'm going to keep my house no matter what, because I want it as an investment. But people are saying I'm going to rent my house, and I'm going to rent my house in Newton. I'm going to go move to Watertown, or I'm going to sell and go to Colorado, or I'm going to get an apartment in New York, or I'm going to, you know, people aren't staying here that I know. I mean, I know we all live in different parts of Newton, and that's part of the complexity of this issue is that there are parts of Newton that are, you know, really beautiful, and people have huge pieces of land, and it's very diverse. I happen to live on a very small piece of land, so my neighbors, we are on top of each other, and it's a single house. I mean, I'm in a single
unit.
And
that is the complexity of the problem.
I live with people right on top of me.
There is no single answer that's going to be good for the entirety of the city of Newton.
Right.
That's kind of, one of the things we were trying to get out of this evening is how do we look at the different parts of the city as residents, and then how can we incorporate that into the process of looking at policies and regulations. So with that, I'm going to thank you all for coming out and being part of this. It was a long day. I appreciate your steadfastness. As I end every evening, you have a way to get in touch with me and James. If you have questions, comments, please do not hesitate to reach out. Thank you so much.
Thank you.